The following is a special presentation of ABC Sports. Tradition is what college football is all about. And here in the state of Texas, there is none bigger than the eve of the Texas A&M Texas game. In College Station, they ignite the largest bonfire in the world. And this one's special, folks. This is the day they bring down the curtain on 82 years of great Southwest Conference memories. For the days of Sammy Baugh to Bobby Lane and Doak Walker to Earl Campbell, this is a conference that has featured a little bit of everything. Pageantry's here as the Corps enters Kyle Field prior to another showdown. And this could be the battle of the left ankles. Leland McElroy of Texas A&M is supposed to be 100%, but there are big questions about number 5, quarterback James Brown of the Longhorns. One more time, the shootout in Texas A&M and the Horns. ABC Sports welcomes you to college football. They bring down the curtain on the Southwest Conference, the Texas Longhorns and the Texas A&M Aggies. Take a good look, ladies and gentlemen. Next year, we will no longer be seeing these standings. And right now, if the Horns win or tie, they get a Tier 1 Alliance Bowl bid. Texas A&M must win it. And that's a lot of bull down there in one of the end zones. Good afternoon. Welcome, everybody. With Dick Vermeil, I'm Brett Musburger. Dick, I want to start you out with James Brown and a question. How long can he go on that ankle?
Well, first off, I watched him Wednesday through a full practice session, three-quarter tempo now. It wasn't full speed, but he moved fine. He went through the running game fine. He threw the ball fine. No scramble situations, no pressure. How long he can go today under full speed depends on how big a heart he is and how tough this defense is.
Well, I want to tell you, this is one of the best defenses in the land right here.
Well, statistically, it's the number one defense in the country. When you watch him on tape, you can see why. Fine defensive linemen, linebackers that run as fast as running backs, a secondary that can come up and line up, bump and run, and go man-to-man on you anywhere on the field, and they're led by a fine pass rusher in Keith Mitchell. He can really get after you.
Fascinating coaching matchup. R.C. Slocum, he has dominated Texas lately. John Makovic looking for his first win over the Aggies as the Horns coach. The kickoff is coming up. Through the years, that's what the bonfire once looked like. And last night, a crowd estimated at 70,000 on hand. And John Spagnuolo, this is quite a traditional meeting down here.
Yes, it is, Brent. You know, with the SEC, with the Southwest Conference finally ending here in football, it is very interesting to note that these two teams have combined for 41 titles. That's more than any of the other schools in the Southwest Conference together. Today, they will do battle for the final time, and the bragging rights associated with the winner of this football game will last a long, long time in the state of Texas. Back to you, Brent.
All right, John, thank you. And brother, take a look at that carpet down there, ladies and gentlemen. This is the last day you will see that at Kyle Field. They will tear it up on Monday. And natural grass here, now on their feet. And since the Aggies are kicking off, remember the 12th man, which is the great tradition here, representing the student body. Number 12 is on the outside right. Kerry will represent the student body. There are several young men wearing number 12. They'll come downfield. Here's one of the most dangerous return men in the nation, Mike Adams, number 83, set to bring it back. Bryant. It's the Aggies and the Horns, and here comes Adams from the four. Number 83 has an alley that was shut down quickly in the middle. And now James Brown and all the questions surrounding that ankle. He leads the conference with 19 touchdown passes. That's a Texas record. We have seen number 83, Mike Adams, here on the Chili's backs and receivers. And he certainly could be a key player here. The Texas running game has come of age so far this year with Ricky Williams and Sean Mitchell. Mitchell is number 3. Williams is number 11, set down in front of him. Mitchell to the 29-yard line, and Dat Wynn brings him down. The offensive line features guard Dan Neal, perhaps the best lineman in the Southwest Conference. He squatted 639 pounds, power clean 370, folks. His nickname is Stump.
He's stronger than you are.
Defensively, Keith Mitchell. Now, Brandon Mitchell is the cornerstone, but when they moved Keith outside to that rush defensive end, it made a big difference. Now Brown pushing off alertly on that ankle. High and incomplete, and this will bring up a third down. The defensive backfield features number 24, Ray Mickens. He leads the Aggies with 4 picks. He teams with Donovan Greer to give Texas A&M very steady play now on the corners.
I'll tell you, Texas has to play the best defense they've played all year if they're going to win this football game today. They've got to get 2 long scoring plays out of their passing game, big plays like that, and be plus in the turnover margin.
Two tight ends for Makovic. Good block by Williams, but it's incomplete. It's 3 and out. And Mark Schultes.
Do you see how tight that coverage was, Brent? Boy, tough to throw against that tight coverage.
There is a storyline that we want to pick up on here, and that is that A&M won the toss and took the wind, which is at their back. And now the Aggies will see what they can do about it. Ray Mickens is back deep to return. Schultes standing on the 15-yard line for the Horns. He's been a good punter this year, and this one drives the Aggies back to the 25-yard line. So an excellent punt, all things considered, by Schultes. And now Corey Pulley, a senior. He's attempting to beat Texas 4 straight years, and no Southwest Conference quarterback has ever accomplished that feat. The Chili's backs and receivers feature tailback Leland McElroy. He wears Walter Payton's number 34. He reminds folks of the great one. The tender left ankle probably cost him a legitimate shot at the Heisman this year now. On 1st and 10, coming out from the 25. On a fake to McElroy, Pulley throws on 1st down to the fullback for 11 yards and a 1st down. So slipping out was Detron Smith of Dallas for the reception. The offensive line for the Aggies, guard Calvin Collins. Now he squats 555 pounds. He's a bullish drive blocker, but he's been bothered by a lot of injuries this year. Now, Tony Brackens here for the Texas D is healthy. He leads the Horns in 5 statistical categories, including sacks. So it is 1st down for the Aggies after Pulley's initial reception on 1st down. Now McElroy, sweep left, cut out, and down he goes with big Tony Brackens whacking him good. Now, the defensive backfield for the Horns features free safety Chris Carter. He leads the Horns with 4 interceptions. He has 5 double-digit tackle gains.
Well, they shut him off. He wanted to get outside to the bottom of your right side of your screen. Good defense forced him to slow down. See, read number 40 does a good job of getting him turned back inside, and here comes the defensive end, Tony Brackens.
2nd down and 14. Pulley, and And it's a flanker screen out there to the outside. And that is the fellow who's been their big play wide receiver, Albert Connell from Fort Lauderdale, Florida, the receiver.
I think the A&M keys, Brent, with the man-to-man coverage, they've got to keep the running back receiving yards to a minimum, do a good job offensively on first down like they did the first play, and win the battle in the kicking game. R.C. Slocum really believes in the kicking game in these big, big games.
Well, Dick, we got the bookwork out of the way. Now we can settle down with this baby. We got about a third down. They're calling it 10 on the scoreboard, but it's more like 11. Shotgun for Pulling here. Inside pitch. And here's McElroy. And he may have got the first down. So the call ambushed the Texas D from out of the shotgun, Dick, that little inside pitch.
A little shovel play. They move to get the defensive end upfield to the left side of your screen as you see this from the end zone. They draw the end up toward the quarterback to the left side. Get him up there. They pull the right guard, number 54 there. Collins, he comes up through there. They pitch it forward, which is a lateral. Good call for a third down play.
First down at the 47-yard line. McElroy on a sweep to the right, and the horns string it out beautifully with Jason Reeves, number 88, a senior, bringing him down.
See, that's the important thing in defensing a back like McElroy is to keep him running toward the sideline, Brent. When he runs straight toward the line of scrimmage, he will remind you of a lot of a Barry Sanders. He can widen his base, and he can dart in any direction without losing much speed. Sometimes he overcuts and passes up holes, and they're trying to coach him not to do that. But the best thing is to do what they did then, keeping running toward the sideline.
Second down and 12, underway in College Station. It's the Aggies and the Horns. Pulling. And now the nose man flushes him from the middle. He hits the fullback back at the line of scrimmage, and this will leave them with a third and 12.
Well, one of the real concerns that Steve Hensminger, the offensive coordinator, had in regard to attacking this defense was the play of Chris Akins, the nose tackle inside. He's awfully good football player, and he can pressure the quarterback. Now, they don't want their center to block him one-on-one. They're going to try to give him help. They didn't give him enough help that time.
Chris Akins, the sophomore nose man, leads a three-pack substitution package now for the Horn defense onto the field. They set down in a base 4-3 defensively. Pulling runs the option, and now he pitches to McElroy, who's going to be out of bounds at the 48. A&M will be forced to punt.
That's a little change-up. That's a game plan approach to attacking this defense. They took the slot and went in and cracked the linebacker that would normally scrape in and make the tackle on the option. But the secondary did a good job, Brent, of rotating up there and preventing the first down. Good secondary play.
Well, Dick, if this winds up being a battle of the punters, here is Sean Terry for A&M with Chris Carter. He's going to go back and be a return man.
He's a good punter, Brent, and they had real good punt coverage. He pushed this one purposely away from the return special.
That's a great punt if it getting downed.
He did it.
Knock it back. That's legal. You can't do that in the NFL.
He did it. Excellent, excellent job. Sean Terry did his part. The coverage people did their part. Excellent, excellent job. You talk about being in the hole with a quarterback with a bad ankle. You don't want to be in this spot, Brent.
Watch how he downs it here.
Oh.
Going on in. He didn't break the plane even before he put it down. Very well done. CFA College Football on ABC is brought to you by Chevrolet. The cars and trucks 36 million people depend on every day. Genuine Chevrolet. Chili's Grill and Bar, where steak lovers go for great grilled steaks. State Farm Insurance. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And Bud Light. If you want great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down, make it a Bud Light. The Longhorns, their second possession. And Bevo's boys are in trouble. Buried by a very slick play. It was a freshman, Michael Price from Tyler, Texas, who was able to down the punt inside the 2-yard line. The Horns will be cautious here. the tailback to the 4-yard line that time, was straight ahead. Now watch this play by Price here, coach.
This was just a super job, Brent. You just cannot do it better. If you tried this 50 times on the practice field, you would probably not be able to execute it like this. It's a one in a season job, and you have to credit the special teams coach, Coach Sean Slocum.
That's the son of RC. He has two children. That's the oldest youngster following daddy into the coaching profession. And now it is second down and 9. Brown, and it's a diving reception by Adams, and it was right at the chain. It'll depend on where they spot the ball, and we will see Doyle Jackson's officiating crew whether or not the horns have bailed themselves out.
And Michael Adams did a beautiful job of coming back for the ball. Now, if he misses the first down by 3 inches, he's going to wish he didn't come back quite as hard. But it was thrown low into the outside, and it was, you know, you can't do it much better than that, Brent.
John Spagnuolo, what's up with our quarterback?
Well, Brent, I got a chance to talk to James Brown before the game, of course. He's wearing that air cast, and it is a first down for the Longhorns. I think the concern here today is he's going to lose that initial quickness escaping the rush. That is one of his strengths as a quarterback. And of course, if he gets banged up during the course of the game, that's going to affect his ability to drop back and to step into the ball. Brent?
All right, John. He's a sophomore out of Beaumont, Texas. John Makovic, his strength as a coach is on game day. He is one of the better play callers that we've been around. Now on the toss to Mitchell Alley on a cutback. And Mitchell out to about the 18-yard line. That's a good-looking running play on first down, coach.
They got the defense stretched, Brent. Now, a defense that is quick and flows like these people do at A&M, you get that one block at the point of attack, get the defense stretched, and if the running back will run controlled enough so he can take advantage of it and cut back like he did that time, you're going to move the ball.
Would you agree with me about Makovic as a play
no
caller?
Question. Offensively, he just does a great job.
Second down and 3. And Mitchell is cut off this time. And Mitchell, number 23, was there. He was the last of the maroon shirts to hit him. And that win, number 9, also in on the stop.
Mitchell is not known for his run defense ability. He's a pass rusher, number 23, to the right side. But he does a good job of standing up the offensive lineman, staying square to the line of scrimmage, bending his knees, throwing them, and moving in to make the play.
Well, now here's a 3rd and 4.
Okay.
With Brown, Makovic able to throw, has the experience, something he might not have done with the freshman, but Edward Jasper, number 95, the junior, in to make that stop.
Both of those tackles inside, Pat Williams and Edward Jasper, 95, Brent, are very physical. Plus, they can whip blocks. Plus, as he did that time, 95, Jasper, he jumps around people. Boy, when a deep offensive guard has to block that guy one-on-one, he's got problems.
Mickens ready to return this punt. This figures to give A&M excellent field position. And remember, this goes back to the Aggies punt by Sean Terry that was down inside the 2-yard line. They go after this one a bit. And the Aggies will let it roll down. It was touched at about the 47-yard line. That ball was touched by a Longhorn player up at the 47. Let's see if the officials get this straightened out. We'll be right back. Well, last week with Oklahoma-Nebraska, we brought down the curtain on the Big 8. And today, after 82 years, it is the Southwest Conference coming to an end down here in the state of Texas. Probably began when Arkansas made its way over to the Southeastern Conference. And now this conference is divided in half at the conclusion of 2 games today. Rice and Houston actually play the conference's last game. And these 4 teams will join the new Big 12. And there you see in the Southern Division, Texas and Texas A&M are joined by Oklahoma, Oklahoma State, Baylor, and Texas Tech. Folks, that is going to be a powerful, powerful conference. Meanwhile, those other teams will go into the WAC with the exception of Houston, which joins Conference USA. The WAC will expand to 16 teams. And yes, like the Big 12, they too will have a playoff game next year. First down and 10 now near midfield for the Aggies. We're scoreless. It's Texas and Texas A&M. And Pulleg with a great play fake. Throws, and it is incomplete. He had a receiver wide open that time.
Aaron Oliver was crossing through the zones. Now, Aaron Oliver has been the fourth wide receiver, but Dante Hawkins got hurt last week, Brent, and here he is throwing to the left side of your screen. He just threw right over the top of him and almost into the defender's hands.
Second down and 10. The one thing that was impressive about Pulleg was the play fake that time. It's a basic I formation now with Smith in front of McElroy. So the Aggies came to throw on first down. They're running McElroy on second down, and they may run him a lot more often after that hole on the left side. It was a monster. First down, Aggies.
Well, you have a strong offensive line like this over on the left side. Chris Ruma, number 76, Steve McKinney, all big people. They can really come off the ball. Then they pull the big right guard, Collins, around their number 54, and he buries the linebacker, and through the hole they go.
To the Longhorns, 41-yard line. A slot formation to the right for the Aggies. And here he comes again. Number 34 to the 32-yard line, and McElroy starting to take control.
Defensive end played down into the offensive tackle, Chris Ruman, that time, and constricted it. But McElroy is so shifty, and he has the ability to bounce wherever he wants to go. Concentrate on his base. He always has his feet in a position that he can go where he wants to go.
Splitbacks. Same spot. This time the horns close it down, and McElroy makes the most of it. First down for Texas A&M. Stoney Clark is there defensively.
I'll tell you, there was a lot of contact at the point of attack that time. Big fullback D'Tron Smith did a good job of kicking out, created the hole inside, but the pursuit just kept right on coming, and he didn't get as much out of that as that block that D'Tron Smith gave the running play.
Now the Aggies send a second tailback into the game. DeAndre Hardeman. He's a freshman, and he's a good one. He is offset from McElroy now to the quarterback's right. Hayward Clay, the tight end, goes on that side. And Pulleg setting the screen, and he overthrew the youngster Hardeman. Oh, they had sent him into the game with this special play. He overthrows him, and the penalty flags, our first yellow of the day, come flying.
Corey Pulleg's upset with himself there, Brent. And whenever in the game plan, when we see a halfback come in a fullback position, we got to concentrate on him. They're going to try to get him the ball. Well, you wouldn't think it would be that difficult to throw that complete screen, but there was a white jersey in there, Brent.
Jackson explaining the options to the horns, Dick, because this one wasn't going to be good anyway.
Right.
The foul was an illegal touch downfield by the offense. Also loss of down, second down.
That's a critical mistake, and it all comes from misfiring on a wide open receiver when he inadvertently hits an ineligible receiver, and now it becomes second and 15. The senior quarterback struggling a little bit, but that's his MO. He'll look real bad for a while, and then suddenly Pulleg will come alive as he did last week. The handoff to McElroy, big hole left side. McElroy dances to the 19-yard line, short of the first down, but A&M back in business.
When you have good defensive linemen that like to get after the quarterback, one of the best plays you can run is a draw play. Offensive linemen set short. They're running a quick draw now. They get the ball up to the line of scrimmage real quick. D'Tron Smith to the left side of your screen, number 44, does a nice lead job, and you're giving the ball to the right kind of back on a draw play.
Dick, that's 40 yards, seven carries for Leland. The A&M kicking game has been a disaster for much of this year. So the Aggies, you never know what they've got in mind here. They got two downs to get that first down.
Bumble. Bumble!
The Horns have got it at the 22-yard line. Taji Allen of Lubbock recovers the fumble forced by Stoney Clark.
He came in from behind the ball carrier and hit him from behind and knocked that ball out. Real good pursuit. Defense first did a good job at the point of attack, Brent. He goes to turn up inside. Coming from the right side of your screen, you see Stoney Clark, 55, flash in there and knock him down. Good job by Stoney Clark. Now, he's a rotating third defensive tackle. He doesn't start, but he plays often. Here he is. He just knocks it out of there. There it is. And to win, they have to be plus in turnovers.
Now, you know, a big part of Coach Makovic's game plan has to be the tight end. But so far, James Brown has not looked in the direction of Pat Fitzgerald. Double tight end now for the Horns, and one running back. Off a play fake, Brown throws, and there's Fitzgerald. So right away, Fitzgerald makes an impact with his first reception. It's 11 yards and a first down. John Saunders in Atlanta. Let's go to him now. Ricky Williams and Wayne McGarrity. McGarrity in a tailback. Brown back, fires, and it is complete for 9 yards to the 42-yard line.
Michael Adams did a real nice job of running a curl into a zone. Now, Texas A&M does not play a lot of zone defense, Brent. It's a changeup when they play zone. This time they're in a zone. They read it properly, a little play action there. They stretch it outside. Now he turns back inside, and Brown shows he can sit up nicely. Fortunate for him, it's his left ankle that's bothering him, not his right ankle, so he can really push off a good ankle to throw the ball downfield.
I think here's the measurement after the Adams reception. You can see what they have left. This puts him in second and short.
With their ability to give the ball to a Sean Mitchell and a Ricky Williams in these situations, Brent, you know, and a quarterback that can run, no wonder they call it the BMW Express. That's quite a driving machine.
Adams is off to the left. Williams is the lone running back. Two tight ends for the Horns. Off a fake, Brown in trouble, gets it off, complete. Fitzgerald, a bit of a safety valve in that instance, and I believe he is short of the first down. It was a good hit by Dennis Allen. He had Fitzgerald off balance.
Dennis Allen is an excellent tackler, Brent. I noticed that in looking at the game tape. When he comes up to tackle you, he can really nail you. Good form. There's Fitzgerald. But see the technique right there. The knees bent, the shoulder pads into the man first. That's why he's able to knock him back.
They just made it, and it is a first down. The ball at the 49-yard line. We're scoreless here. 3:55 to go, first quarter. It's a slot formation to the left. Brown, incomplete, as Justin McLemore made the turn. He thought he had the ball, and as he turned, broke his concentration, and he dropped the ball. So it will be second and 10.
I really believe he turned his head before the ball actually hit his body. He wanted to be a running back with the ball in his hand before a receiver, Brent. That's the most common error a young receiver makes. Hey, they make the same mistake in the National Football League. Right there. See his head getting ready to turn there?
Now Williams offsets as a fullback. Fumble! On the exchange. So James Brown,
that should
covers
never
it up right away, but it will bring up a big one, Dick, here, third and 11.
Boy, and that's a tough situation to convert against a defense like this, but they pride themselves in playing super third down defense. They only give up 27%, and that's outstanding, Brent. They can pressure you, and they can do both. They can cover you.
Dick McGarrity now moves over on a wing.
They like to throw him the ball when he's in there.
Williams is just off to the left.
Pressure inside.
Won't get it off, and it's a fumble. The Aggies pounce on it at the 34-yard line, but the whistle.
They blitz the inside linebackers. Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator, said we're going to come after him on those third and long situations because we have confidence we can play man. Here comes the linebackers up inside. There's Larry Walker, number 32, outside that time. Number 46, Reggie Brown. Great pressure.
They ruled that it was down, and the Horns survived that one. It is fourth down, and Schultes. He'll be right back. Golf tomorrow on ABC at 2:30 Eastern. We present two spectacular events. First, Jack Nicklaus and Tom Watson meet again at Pebble Beach in Shell's Wonderful World of Golf. Then the stars of the men's and ladies tour pair up on the JCPenney Classic all tomorrow right here on ABC. And then Monday Night Football. Both the Bears and the Lions are in hot pursuit of the Green Bay Packers. Big one in the NFC Central. Eric Kramer for the Bears and Barry Sanders for the Lions. Bears Lions, 9 Eastern time. Now, if we go back, and that replay indicated clearly, as you saw the first time, this is a fumble and should have been the Aggies' ball. There's no question that was a fumble. No doubt about it.
None whatsoever. Christmas came a little bit early.
Now Schultes, and the Horns say thank you very much. The Aggies were coming last time. Off the side of his foot. That can happen.
Got a good bounce.
The 31-yard line. No score here. First quarter, 2:19 to go. Coach Slocum. Well, he's won the last four against the Horns.
In preparing for this ball game, he told me he just stressed with his squad that there's going to be some highs and some lows. What I want you to do is just take consistent, maintain concentration. Don't get too excited when things go well, and don't get down when they go badly. We can beat this football team. That's what he's stressing.
Dick, what's impressed you about McElroy so far?
Well, I like it when he attacks the line of scrimmage. When he tries to go outside, they're pushing him to the sideline. I think they should run at him a little bit more.
They broke concentration on the right side that time, and that was Hayward Clay who broke the snap count. This will make it first and 15. This will be a dead ball foul against the Aggies.
Hayward Clay made a catch in the game last week, Brent. Just showing great, great hands. This guy can, he's been waiting his turn to play football for him. He's been a backup for 3 years. Here he is, a senior starting, and can he catch the football? He's going to be a bigger factor in the game plan. Steve Ensminger said they were going to back him off the line and play him as a wing off the line and let him run option routes against the linebackers.
How about Albert Connell, the receiver from Fort Lauderdale, who has caught 7 touchdown passes this year? Have you been impressed watching him?
Well, so far, they really haven't gotten him the
football. No, I mean in the tape.
Oh, yes, Brent, no question.
You would think that they'd try to find him pretty soon. High and incomplete. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar couldn't have caught that one. Aaron Oliver, the intended receiver.
Yeah, the running back or the basketball player?
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Guy. I remember that. We saw him play, and he was a heck of a player.
Yeah. For me, there's only one big fella, Coach.
Yeah, that's right.
The other's an imposter. I don't care. Second down and 15. Now Clay will change over to the right side. So the formation with an extra blocker over there. McElroy dances back to the middle. Nothing doing. The Horns were ready this time. Tony Blackens, number 98. You cannot say how much he has meant to this defense since he returned to good health.
Yeah. With him, they're about twice as good as they are without him, Brent. In point prevention and in his total yards, this guy has done a great job. He's got another year of eligibility. And Coach Gary Darnell says he's a basketball player, athletic ability-wise, that plays defensive linemen like a football player. Good combination.
Coach, we got third and long, and so they're going to back him up in a shotgun, give Pulling a look at the field. And there was a whistle prior to the snap. Too much time. The Aggies hurting themselves. Makovic attempting to win for the first time over A&M as head coach at Texas. And you get the feeling that public opinion about John is starting to finally turn around just a little bit down here in the state of Texas. And of course, if you look over at the W column, there's always a good reason why. Folks are standing all around the stadium for this one. I don't see how they can see down there on that track. They're all standing up. McElroy up the middle. A beautiful run, but well short of the first down. That was, remember, third and 20, so the Aggies will be punting, and Brackens makes another defensive play. So, Tony, number 98, very active in the early going. And now it is Sean Terry who got off that beautiful punt that Michael Price was able to down at the one-yard line, and this time Adams will go back deep.
He's an excellent punt returner. Brandy averages 14-7 coming into this ball game. He can really do it.
Leads the Southwest Conference. They almost get it. What a punt under pressure that is. Adams fair catches it at the 17-yard line. But how about the job that Sean Terry is doing here today?
You know, he had his best game of his career last year against Texas, average 45-8. He has the one he downs on the one-yard line. He punts under tremendous pressure right here and nails a dandy. He must love punting against the Longhorns.
Tony Holmes almost had something going right up the middle, didn't he?
Look at that short hair. You know, I'm walking around this campus the last few days. I've never seen so many people with short hair in my life. It's refreshing.
Good barbers down there.
Good barbers down there. They're making a living, I'll tell you.
Ricky Williams, outstanding baseball prospect, signed by the Philadelphia Phillies, is the running back. The defensive lineman apparently got back. That's great speed down there in that front. Pat Williams and Jasper credited with the tackle. But I think as you watch A&M on defense, you will notice with the snap how quickly they move. It has been throughout the last decade, certainly since Slocum came as the defensive coordinator under Jackie Sherrill and then became the head coach. The one thing that they have always featured down here is speed on defense. It is second down and 10 now.
Brent, and they start everything in defensive recruiting with their corners, because if they get corners who can play man-to-man, that allows them to do many different things with their front seven there.
Well, punter Sean Terry was happy they took the wind, but other than that, that's about all they accomplished.
After graduation, I want to be governor of Texas.
Governor of Texas. Governor of Texas. Governor of Texas. Governor of Texas. Governor of Texas. Governor of Colorado. Well, 5 out of 6 isn't bad. At the schools of the Southwest Conference, higher education turns dreams into reality.
Well, there's a great honor. All walk-ons, the 12th man kickoff team, and 4 or 5 of them in uniform. The spirit here in Aggieland, hoping that Texas A&M can score some points so they can go down the field on the kickoffs against these Horns. Scoreless in the first quarter. Now Texas with the wind at its back. McGarrity still in place of Sean Mitchell, and James Brown, tender ankle and all, still quarterbacking the Horns. It's scoreless, and Brown pulls out down the middle, incomplete. Just a little high on the throw. It's interesting that Brown may have thought, I'll take off. Whether it was the ankle or the defense, he seemed to change his mind when he was back in the pocket. Maybe he spotted something.
Plus, I think he saw the pressure of the defensive lineman picked up there, and it gave him some time to go ahead and let this crossing pattern develop. He just has to throw it accurately when he gets that kind of time.
It is 3rd and 10.
This is the time that the Aggies like to come after you. Challenge him man-to-man and bring linebackers. Here they come. They're bringing four to the one side. Here they come.
Brown in trouble.
Middle ISO one-on-one incomplete. Had his big play guy there. Adams had a step. And had it just been about a yard shorter, it might have been hello end zone for the Horns. But it was not to be because of the pressure. And now Texas will punt it away.
Well, they had the right thing called. They went to the right people. He just didn't get enough time to really concentrate and throw that ball downfield because he really took a shot right up underneath the chin.
Schultes standing inside the Horns 5-yard line. Mickens back deep. And that punt is out of bounds. Mickens is trying to lobby, and he's winning so far. They're going to mark it at the 40-yard line. Crowd wants another 3 or 4 yards, but that's all they're going to get. We're scoreless in College Station. Well, we've got a moment. We'd like to welcome a new member of the ABC family, station WPTY Memphis 24. Proud to be in our new home in Western Tennessee and Eastern Arkansas beginning today. So welcome to ABC. We hope you enjoy that relationship. And Dick, I'll tell you that negative yardage for Texas rushing really stands out on that page.
Oh, partner. It really does, Brent, because they came in so confident they could run the ball. They've been averaging over 240 yards a game in the last 5 weeks of the season. They're going to have to run much better than that if they expect to win the football game.
A&M coming into the win now, and Hardeman, number 20, is checked back in. Oh, is he fumbled? Texas pounces on it. That was Bryant Westbrook.
That was a great change-up call by Gary Darnell, bringing the left corner. You don't read a corner for a blitz situation, Brent. That is tough, and it's an excellent change-up call. Quarterback's in play action, looking away. He can't see him, and Westbrook just comes off the bottom of your screen. Here he comes. The safety rotates over, and wham, right in there, and there's a ball on the ground. Boy, that is tough.
And he recovers the fumble, Dick. Watch the alertness after he delivers the blow. He's quick enough to get to the loose ball. Texas now with their first opportunity, Dick. And John can open it up from the Texas sideline. Mitchell checks back into the game with Ricky Williams. So Sean Mitchell, he's the second back. He's the tailback. Brown slips in trouble. Middle. Incomplete, threw it away and saved a huge loss.
He tripped up, but in stumbling like that, that puts a lot of pressure on the bad ankle in regaining balance. You can't do that too many times with a bad ankle without hurting it more and end up sitting on the bench in the third quarter, Brent. McAvick is not a conservative offensive coach. He will go after them. Now, in game planning, he wanted to get his running backs on linebackers. So far, he hasn't done that.
This is going against the Horns.
You know that hit that caused the fumble? In the NFL, they would have probably called a 15-yard penalty against the hitter because he hit him with his helmet. He hit him with his helmet. He can't do that anymore in the NFL.
This is like an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty against the Horns.
That is a dead ball, unsportsmanlike offense, second down.
Boy, I didn't see it. John McAvick checking his game plan card. He calls his own plays, coordinates his own offense. Here's the blitz from the left side. See that helmet right up under the chin there? In the NFL, don't they fine you for about $5,000 on that one?
Down here in Texas, they just give the other team the ball and say, let's play.
Yeah, and say, nice job.
It's second down and 25. Sean Mitchell to the 44-yard line with Andre Williams, a junior defensive back, bringing him down. That penalty really stalled that scoring opportunity.
Oh,
that
no
15-yarder
question.
Was huge against the Horns.
Now they're in the extreme third and long, like third and 20, Brent. And I wouldn't be surprised to see him blitz this situation. They like to come after you on third and long. If you're going to go to a hot receiver, dump it off quickly and then tackle the receiver before he can make the first down. It doesn't look like they're gonna. It looks like a zone. It's a zone.
Now with time. Had a man open underneath and threw incomplete. John Spagnuolo.
Well, Brent, Andre Williams made that tackle a couple of plays ago. He's in the game because Donovan Greer, the starting left cornerback, sprained his knee and may not return. So we'll see if John Makovic and James Brown go after the backup cornerback, Andre Williams. Brent?
John, that's been a lingering injury down here. And Andre actually has come on and played pretty well for him throughout the season. They were hoping that Greer would hold up here today, but earlier this year he was out. And so Andre has a lot of game experience. It is fourth down and 22. Schultes, who has not been punting as well as he was coming into this game, off the side of his foot. The Aggies survive a turnover. We're scoreless. It's Texas and A&M. A heck of a year, and congratulations to Coach Ford and the Razorbacks, no matter what happens. That's a team that beat Alabama, that beat Auburn. They're going to be in deep tonight. I don't know if their safeties can hold up against Coach Spurrier's passing attack. It's a thing of beauty. Now, speaking of a thing of beauty, here's McElroy. He's rushed for about 56 yards here this afternoon. Richardson on the stop for the Horns. We're scoreless, 13:29 to go. Dick, some folks are probably just coming a little bit late, just turning on their set. Give us a little bit of overview here. What have we seen between Texas and Texas A&M so far?
So far, we've seen two defensive teams playing extremely well. Two quarterbacks struggling a little bit, Brent, when they have a guy open. They throw it over the top. They haven't completed the pass. Therefore, they don't convert the third down situation. Defenses both playing well.
So McElroy up over 1,000 on this season as a junior. There's a completion by Pullig, but a nice stop by Jason Reeves, who had slipped outside for pass coverage out there. Now, you know, we spoke of McElroy, and as a junior, it has been a disappointing year because of the injured left ankle. He came in probably the preseason favorite to win the Heisman until they lost up in Colorado.
He has that kind of ability, though, when he's 100% healthy, Brent.
So it's third and three, and off a fake, Pullig fires, complete, and their penalty flag comes down, but the fullback, Smith, hung on with Westbrook delivering a blow, and that's going to be a first down for the Aggies, whether it's pass interference or the pass was a caught. That's not going to matter.
They call it the pass interference. Westbrook did a real nice job on that thing there. The ball was thrown a little bit late, and that's why he ended up getting his body all over the receiver. If it was thrown on time, it would have been complete. Probably no pass interference. No difference, though, right?
You know, Dick, before we went to commercial, Schultes' punt for Texas was only 15 yards. The biggest difference that we've seen in this game so far has been between the two punters. Sean Terry has been magnificent for the Aggies so far.
And therefore, the Aggies really, throughout this first part of the game, have had halfway decent field position.
But they've been unable to take advantage of it. Now let's see what Pullig can do with a first down, fresh set of downs. Ball at the 45-yard line. Smith is in front of McElroy. McElroy, right side, alley, midfield, 45, out of bounds at the 41-yard line.
That's what he does best, Brent. Attack the line of scrimmage, find a crease. If you constrict too much from the outside into containing, get too much leaning inside, he can bounce outside and accelerate. You'll see him do this. He gets outside. Brackets could get to him. He's upfield like that with good burst of speed. Well, he's sudden. He is sudden. One fastest guy on the team at 4.27 in the 40.
That's 12 carries for 68 yards. Another first down for the Aggies. The ball is at the Horns' 41-yard line. We're scoreless here in the second quarter.
Coming after him. Here it is.
On the release. Intercepted because of the blitz.
It's a biggie.
Picked off by Carter. Carter down the sideline. And Carter is out of bounds at the 34-yard line. A huge defensive call by the Horns. And
the pressure pays off.
Gary Darnell made that call. You said it was a good call, Brent. I agree with you. He changed up with the blitz, got him, got right in his face. He threw it up there, had the guy downfield, actually, Brent, but the safety came over there, and Carter has intercepted four already coming into this game. He gets his fifth, and this guy is a gifted athlete. And offensively, they were concerned about this guy as a free safety because he covers a lot of ground back there.
That is the third Aggy turnover of this game. It's the fifth interception of the season for Chris Carter. It gives Texas a first down at the A&M 33-yard line. Lots of time to go in the first half. 11 minutes and 40 seconds. Brown on the handoff, and Williams is hit and taken down by Larry Walker, the junior.
I watched Larry Walker play on tape, and he is a blur. And you know something? He's second string. He's the fastest maybe linebacker in the country, and they have another linebacker. Warwick Holderman actually plays in front of him, who has been injured. And they say these two guys next year will dominate the Big 12 as inside linebackers.
Go, 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 go.
Now 11 minutes and 5 seconds. Second down and 13 for the Horns. Mitchell trying to squirt through a hole on the right side to the 34-yard line, and Walker, number 32, seals it up again.
Both defenses playing very fast flow. Both offenses a little better running straight ahead, getting that 4- and 5- and 6-yard gain. Doing a little better job. We'll probably see more of that as we go. That's Pete, Phil Bennett right there, the defensive coordinator. He played here when Slocum was his linebacker coach, Brent, years ago. He's an intense guy, and the defense reflects his personality.
His defense has been excellent on third down. Texas is 0-5. This is their sixth try.
Here they
here
come.
They come again, and down goes Brown on the blitz as Larry Walker turns in a brilliant defensive series for the Aggies.
See, the offensive left guard, Corby Brooks, has to block down on that. Everybody has to come down and seal that inside gap. That's such an easy thing to do, Brent. Here it is, left gap right there. No one picks him up. They're trying to get him with the running back. You can't do it. The running back can only block him if he slides to the side of the quarterback and gets up in front of him. You can't get him that way.
And Brown is limping to the sideline. This is the moment that Texas and its fans feared. A redshirt freshman, Richard Walton, who quarterbacked against Baylor, will be getting up and preparing over there on the far sideline. The Aggies have survived 3 turnovers in this game.
The University of Texas at Austin, building strong communities through education, service, and teamwork. Students learning the value of earning, the meaning of work, and the importance of giving through community service. Building neighborhoods, lending a hand to friends in need. UT teamwork, creating a brighter future, instilling strong values, teaching life skills and leadership to build communities in Texas. The University of Texas at Austin.
John, thank you. And here is James Brown. He certainly is the storyline of the moment with a tender ankle. And he's over on the far side. His backup, Walton, has been up while you were away and loosening up. He's listening over there on the sideline right now. He's out of Bay City, Texas. This would be a tough, tough spot for redshirt freshman. And Brown over there indicating that he'll be coming on. Now, Schultes has struggled. The Texas punting game has not been good here today so far. Mickens will let this one bounce, and it takes an Aggie hop down to the 16-yard line. Well, it's the home turf. Dick, I think that Brown was trying to protect the left ankle here.
Well, he kept his left ankle off the turf. You can see that. He might have sprained the right one slightly, but he kept the left one, which is his injured ankle, out of harm's way.
John Spagnuolo.
Well, I talked to the training staff here down at the Texas sideline. James Brown didn't twist his ankle. They were relieved about that. He landed on it, and he's walking it off here on the sideline. He's progressively moving a little bit better, although he's still gingerly moving around here on the sideline. Brent, back to you.
All right, John. Leland McElroy is the tailback. Detron Smith is the fullback. 9.5 minutes to go, first half. Texas and Texas A&M are scoreless. Aggies coming out for the 16. The big fella, McElroy, to the 21.
Brent, they ran that corner blitz again that time, and he bluffed it first, then backed out, and then came with it, and he almost got to the point of exchange in the handoff, but fortunately, they were handling the ball straight ahead, got up there, and made 4 yards. Good thing they weren't throwing it.
So Bryant Westbrook, successful once, is sneaking in on that left corner. Now they have him matched up against Albert Connell over here. Connell is the right outside receiver for the Aggies on second down. McElroy on a cutback. Very close to the first down. The spot will determine it. He appears to be just a little bit short. Stoney Clark, 320 pounds of Mr. Stoney Clark, was there defensively.
Stoney Clark. He's an English major. With a name like that, you wouldn't think he'd be an English major. Maybe a geology major, huh? McAvitt talking with his quarterbacks there. This guy is, like you said earlier, really good game day.
8:20 now to go, and on third and short, the Aggies right straight ahead for the first down. So it is first and 10, Texas A&M with the ball coming out from their own 27-yard line. McElroy comes over to the A&M sideline. Sir Parker is his backup. Detron Smith is the fullback. Quick hit to Connell, and it's incomplete.
He audible to that, Brent. He saw the three deep defense with the corner back off and the safeties rotated over the wide side of the field, and he audible to the quick hit, which is a good job. Just got to complete it.
You know, Pulig was shaken up also, Dick. That time he fumbled when Westbrook got to him. He received some medical attention over here on the A&M sideline. It is second down and 10. The Aggies with the ball on their own 27-yard line. Pulling from the left as the completion to Connell. Connell short of the first down. It'll be third and 2. Allen there defensively for Texas.
Connell's a junior college transfer. He wasn't even here in spring practice. Got here in the fall, and he's really made a contribution. 37 receptions coming in here, 16.9 average. Now, that's number one in the conference. That's a good, you know, it's been a long time since they've had a real quality wide receiver at Texas A&M.
Sir Parker continues to be the tailback. McElroy taking a series off. This is third and 2, and the whistle.
I think big Chris Room and the left tackle moved. Now, you mentioned Sir Parker. He's a true freshman out of Locke High School in Los Angeles. I said, what are you doing back here going to school with all those universities in the state? He said, my brother lives in Houston. I wanted to be close to him. Plus, I liked it here. And they really think he's going to be a dandy.
Well, that penalty, Dick, will make it third and 7. So number 34 is back off that Aggie sideline. McElroy from Beaumont, Texas. Here he is.
Looks like pressure defense. Yeah, they are.
Downfield, Connell, first down, Aggies, 45-yard line.
See, when you come with a pressure defense, you're committing rushers, you have to play man-to-man. That time, Connell up there is man-to-man on Tajay Allen, the corner, playing the short side of the field, picked up the blitz, hit the out pattern to the right side of your screen. Here he goes. He's bobbling that thing. Boy, he may not have had possession.
Yeah,
he went out of bounds.
The field judge is coming up on that play, and he's going to change it.
Yeah, good call. Good officiating. One bad call, one good call.
They said he did not have possession, and that means the Aggies will be punting, and Sean Terry with Mike Adams back deep and 6:58 to go.
That's a return type punt if he can feel it. He can't feel it, though.
It's a beautiful punt. Yeah. I mean, Terry's been the MVP for the Aggies so far.
He's kicking it purposely away and in front of his sprinter. That was a low line drive, but he did that on purpose. He put it over to the right side, right in front of his sprinter, away from the return man.
A 54-yard punt by Terry. Next Saturday at 1 Eastern, the premiere of ABC's college basketball. You'll watch either Villanova, one of the powers, the Big East, against Purdue with the Big Ten, or Florida State of the ACC against DePaul. It's all next Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern, right here on ABC.
Villanova's ranked number 3 in the country, isn't it?
One of the best
quarterbacks in the conference, right?
James Brown continues at quarterback. And on first down, incomplete. Adams interference. That will be a first down on pass interference. Ray Mickens, just a little too tough against Adams. What a matchup that is. If we could watch Mickens and Adams go at it here today, two big timers.
Two guys that'll play on Sunday, and Mickens is only 5'8", Brent, but he can vertical jump 39 inches high. That's getting up in NBA quality leaping ability. See, that time they took Mickens from his normal right corner position and flopped him over to the left, which he doesn't normally play, just to cover and take that guy on man-to-man. Maybe we're going to see a little bit more of that as the game goes.
It's exactly what they're doing
right now.
Mickens has locked on to Adams. Ricky Williams to the 29-yard line on first down. Boy, 6.5 minutes to go now and no score.
That defense absolutely flies when that ball starts parallel to the line of scrimmage. They just fly out of there. Maybe time to come with some kind of a counter or reverse. I know they have those kind of things in the game plan.
Well, the Aggies with 5 penalties and 3 turnovers. They are very fortunate to still be scoreless, making that many mistakes in the first half. Second down and 7 now for the Horns. Oh, there's interference again. The wide receiver for Texas, Justin McLemore, was hit by Andre Williams, and that'll be a first down. That bails the Horns out.
I kind of look for them, Brent, with that coverage being that tight, to use some little wrinkle out and up and go ahead and try to get the ball deep. We have not seen that done yet. Plus, it doesn't take a lot of time. 5-step drop and let it go.
Well, they were coming once on that pressure, and they busted Adams wide open in the middle off
that play.
Off
that post pattern, he missed that one. These corners can run so well that they're not afraid. They're confident.
So the penalty moves the ball out to the Horns' 42-yard line. It's first down, and it's scoreless. And there's Mickens, number 24. He's got his hands full with Adams. End around.
There it is.
Here comes Adams. Midfield. Another first down for the Horns.
Real good call there by Coach Makovic. Gene, of course, the offensive coordinator in the press box coordinating. But you can see that here, looking down there. When the ball moves parallel to the line of scrimmage, those red jerseys, maroon jerseys flying, gets a nice block over right here to clean it up there, and he gets that running lane for the first down. But you have to slow down that pursuit. Draws would help, too, in terms of those ends coming upfield. Get up underneath him with the draw plays.
Now Mickens switches over to the left side of the defense. Adams is over there on the right side of the offense. It is first down. Brown looks left, fires complete, out of bounds at the 36-yard line, and that time he went to Justin McLemore of Waxahachie. John Saunders.
Well, coming up, back to you.
All right, John, here's the handoff now in a scoreless game to Sean Mitchell. And Mitchell is out of bounds inside the 35. That was Tyfel McMullen in pursuit there defensively. Let me reset the scene here. We're coming up on 4 o'clock. We've got 5:23 to go. Texas A&M and Texas are scoreless. This is the day that they bring down the curtain on 82 years of memories. What great names have played in the Southwest Conference? Bobby Lane, Earl Campbell, John David Crow won a Heisman right here. Darryl Royal, Frank Broyles, Davey O'Brien, Bob Lilly, Don Meredith. We could go on all day. Each name you mention brings back a new memory, and they're trying to write another chapter here today. Second down now for the Horns. The ball is inside the 35. Brown snaps one off short of the first down on that far side. Sean Mitchell slipping out of the backfield, but this will put Texas in third and short.
See, what they did that time, Brent, is they took Mitchell out of the backfield, lined him up as a wide receiver. Now, that put him one-on-one on a strong safety because A&M moves both corners to the wide field on the slot. That's a good matchup. We might see a little bit more of that as it goes on.
Now, the Aggie defense has been invincible on third down. Can they do it one more time?
That was not a legal formation, I don't think, was it? Let's see what they called. They also tried to go on a very quick count to catch that defense on its heels. John McAvick has always liked to use quick counts and then get the ball outside. They haven't converted a third down yet in this ballgame that I can remember. Coach Mickens right there.
Third down and six after the 5-yard penalty for the Horns. McElroy is out to the right.
They're bringing five down linemen, Brent. No one's going to get any inside help.
Bounced on the carpet. That's an incompletion, and now it is fourth down.
Five down linemen covering all the people. Then they bring the inside backer. Good call by Phil Bennett.
Now, Phil Dawson was over there on the sideline.
He's a long-range field goal kicker, Brent. A long-range kicker.
Three of his last six field goals have been absolute monsters here. 50 yards or longer. And remember, he hit that game winner against Virginia. He'll try a 48-yarder. He's got the wind at his back. Powerful lay. No good.
That's about as much emotion as you'll see Coach McAvick show right there. Good play or bad play. And that was a bad play.
So the ball comes out to the line of scrimmage on that missed field goal. It comes out to the 31-yard line. Remember, in the NFL, it'll come out to the spot where it was put down, that new wrinkle. So in the NFL, it'll cost you an extra 7 yards. Not so in the college game. Out at the 31-yard line, though, the Aggies will take it. It's still scoreless. And this time, the Texas defense just ganging up with Kyle Richardson.
You know, Kyle Richardson is playing better today than I saw him play on game tape. He has taken his game to another level. He's really done a nice job. He made a long pursuit play inside out earlier in the ball game on a critical tackle. He just made that play right there. Nice job, young man. That's the way to raise your standards. Be the best against the best.
Second down and 9 with 4:34 to go. Pulling keeps it off the option. And this will leave them around 3rd and 5 as Stoney Clark brings it again.
I like that name, Stoney Clark. He stoned him coming from the inside out. He's a big stone, isn't he?
315, that's a lot of rock.
Well, John Spagnuolo, what about passing into the wind here?
Well, Brent, I talked to Phil Dawson before the game. He said it was the worst wind he's ever kicked in. Keep in mind, he did have that 50-yarder against Virginia. I have a feeling a long-range field goal is still going to affect the outcome of this game, Brent.
It's punt time for the Aggies, and they must punt into this wind. Remember that Dawson missed that last field goal with the wind at his back. And now the Aggies will be punting into it. And here is Sean Terry, who has been brilliant in keeping the ball away from number 83, Michael Adams. Adams is standing back on the 21-yard line, just hoping that he can find a crease and get a returnable punt.
Nice punt. Got up there, hung it up good. He's got a fair catch it.
At the 30-yard line, he does. So we've got 3:14. Scoreless here. And a look at some upcoming shows on ABC. A year ago, Texas A&M took a 24-0 halftime lead on Texas. The Horns then struck back for 10 points, and that's when Leland McElroy returned to kickoff 83 yards. Overall that day, R.C. Slocum's wrecking crew defense held the Horns to 51 yards rushing. Another dynamite defensive performance by the Aggies, who have struggled on offense. James Brown, tender left ankle and all, comes back into the huddle with 3:14 to go. The game is scoreless, and Dick, the Horns are coming out from the 30-yard line.
And they have the wind at their back in this next 3-minute drive. They have all three timeouts, Brent. They might well put that ball in the air and see if they can't do something to it. Tight ends haven't been a factor in the game yet either. Tight coverage, you're probably going to blitz. Yeah, here they come.
Middle complete to the 40-yard line, Justin McLemore.
He threw it just where he had to, out in front, no safety. See, they're up covering a possibility of a back coming out of the backfield in that blitz coverage. He got hit, he laid the ball up high, and in that post-tight move, the receiver, Justin McLemore, who is a good hurdler. I mean, this guy can run. He goes up after the ball, reaches, and gets it out of the air behind him. Nice job.
A 29-yard gain, and the Horns are at the Aggies 41. Now, Texas A&M's been able to come up with the big defensive play when they need it. Horns trying to mount a drive in the last 3 minutes of the first half. Right into the heart that time was Sean Mitchell.
Right into the heart is how they've been most effective running the football. Even though that time they blitzed the weak side linebacker, they got good movement there behind that big, strong right guard, Dan Neal. Might as well try it again.
Dick, the Horns with all three of their timeouts left. 2:25, and Dawson over there, just in case he's needed again.
Actually, now with the three timeouts plus the 2-minute warning.
Now, Quentin Wallace, one of the wide receivers for the Horns. Mickens locked up on Adams on the right side. Brown's going to go for him. Brown's got Adams with a step.
Ooh,
penalty flag. That's pass interference. But I want to tell you, it was probably a well-taken penalty that time. It's going to cost them 15 yards. Remember, this is not like the NFL. It's not first and goal. Basically, Adams had 6 points. We'll see it on the replay.
Laid it up there. See, he looked left. He wings it and gets hit at the same time. Good strong arm. Again, the wind to your back. He reaches out. Obvious. He has 6 points. If he doesn't interfere, good defensive decision right there. He knew he was beaten.
So it will be the 15 and the automatic first down. One of the key differences between the NCAA and the NFL rulebook. Makovic and the Horns will take it right now. But the key statistic, we are still scoreless. No points yet on the board. 2:06 to go now. And a first down. The Horns are threatening. Adams goes off to the right, and Mickens locks up with him. It's become the duel of the game over there on the outside. And Brown sprinting to the right, throws for the incomplete, and basically he tossed that one away.
You know, and I think if he would have had total confidence in that ankle that time, he normally would tuck that ball underneath his arm and go ahead and run with that football. We've got some battles going on out here. And again, give Mickens credit. He just was beaten. He had to interfere to prevent a touchdown. And look at him. He isn't bothered. He's got guts, this guy does. He's hanging in there.
He's a big-time defensive back against one of the best outside threats in college football. And now Mickens comes over to the right side of the defense, and he locks up one-on-one. What a cover corner he is. He's taken Adams all by himself. Second down and 10. Aggy show blitz again. Williams with a hole against that coverage. Williams, five, he'll score. The Horns with the first touchdown of the game by Ricky Williams, 21 yards.
Excellent call by John McEvitt. They caught him in the blitz, handed it off up underneath the blitz to the right side of your screen, and he got up in there. Everyone's passing him, seeing man-to-man down there. The receivers run everybody off. They don't see the back running up behind him. He runs it in for the touchdown.
Now Dawson for the extra point. Bad, but I'll tell you, there was a bobble on the snap, and they have missed. If you will see, and I believe it was Matt Davis on the hold that time, he could not get it down in time, and that is a huge mistake.
That is. You start thinking something like that is automatic. I watched him kick on the field Wednesday. I commented, I visited with those guys. The snaps were good, the placements were good. Doesn't count today if you don't do it right.
Jay Humphrey is the long snapper. Davis the holder, and you can see he bobbles on the snap. It was a little bit low. They can't get it set in time, and Dawson pulls it to the left, and it is 6-0 on the run by Ricky Williams, whose scholarship is being paid for by the Philadelphia Phillies. He has already signed a baseball contract, and so because he's a professional in baseball, the Phillies pay for the scholarship, and they say, hey, come on back, man, you can do better in baseball.
They're a little bit concerned around that if he will come back. You know, he played in Martinville, Virginia last year. I don't know how good he did last summer, but they know he's a real solid prospect.
Pretty good looking running back, coach, on that last sprint.
Oh, you bet. Out of San Diego, California, Patrick Henry High School. Right center of your screen, they hand off the draw play. Gets up inside there. See everybody else playing man-to-man, but he gets a real nice block by Wayne Garrity, the lead blocker on that draw play. Corners out there playing man-to-man. They don't see him running right up their back.
They had a free safety. Dennis Allen had his hands full with McGarrity that time. There was no chance. He couldn't overpower him at all. He's the running back. The blocker got leverage. And now Dawson will kick it along the ground. They do not want McElroy. But instead, it's the short man. And that was Sir Parker they put over there just in case. 147 as the drama continues down here in College Station. Texas leading it 6-0.
They didn't want McElroy to get that ball. And he buried him before, you know. And even last year, I think he returned one back to the one-yard line. Didn't score with it. Before that, though, he had scored with him. I don't think I'd kick to him either.
Dick, what's your evaluation of Corey Pulling so far for A&M at quarterback?
I tell you, to me, early in the ballgame, all through that first part, he looked a little bit tight because he's throwing the ball high and not always under pressure, Brent, just throwing over the top.
McElroy, big hole on the right side. McElroy, 12 yards and a first down.
You know, it's so easy to sit up here and look down and think as a former coach, but when you give the ball to this guy behind an offensive line that comes off the ball well and let him pick his place to run the football, normally he'll find a place. He didn't run at the point of attack. He found another area to go. I just hang with that stuff.
He's a junior, but he'll be going to the NFL with moves like this. He runs a little like the original 34. First and 10 now, and pulling time middle. Midfield with the Aggies working against the clock. 1:21 left, and the running back demonstrating that he can also slip out of the backfield as a receiver. This will be second and 2 after the 8-yard reception. They put the ball in their ace's hands.
He's very dangerous too with the screen type pass when you get it out to him with just one block out there, and in that open area he can fly.
Aaron Oliver is out wide to the left. Pulling now under pressure, steps away from Westbrook, incomplete. So the defense, now there's a penalty flag down. A late flag.
Defensive coordinator Gary Darnell came again with that weak corner blitz. At halftime, they're going to have to make some adjustments.
Here's the throw. That was Brackens. But,
Tony Brackens.
What do you think about this, Coach? Was he
I think maybe hit him high with the arm. That's what it, it's not a vicious hit, but he hit him pretty high with that forearm, and that's what they're calling.
Yep. As a result, the ball is taken inside the 35-yard line. Now, the key is the clock.
Two
51
timeouts.
51 seconds and two timeouts. Trailing it by six. Sir Parker is the tailback to the 32-yard line. Pickup of about three. And let's see if the Aggies, they do. They use a timeout. That leaves them with one remaining and 43 seconds. We'll take a break and come right back. The Horns lead it, but the Aggies are driving. Kyle Bryant says, hey, coach, don't forget about me, although it's been struggle city for the A&M kicker. He's made only 5 of 13. Coach left him on the bench for two makeable kicks versus TCU. Meanwhile, Brown keeping that left ankle elevated over there on the Texas sideline. Now the key number is to remember, 43 seconds to go. This is second and seven. One timeout for the Aggies, Dick.
Well, Brent, they have a real good screen game. I've watched them work on in the practice, and they have the Pete McElroy with him in the open field on the screen. You're out wide. You can get it out of bounds. Chances are you're going to make some yards with it.
Pulling under pressure. Gets it off. Just short of the first down with Robert Reed. Hanging on to the receiver at the 25-yard line. Fullback Detron Smith goes down.
Sir Parker.
Timeout. A&M right now. So John Saunders with a preview of Florida and Arkansas tonight. The winner there moves into a Tier 1 Alliance Bowl, and of course, if it's the Gators, they'll be headed for a great showdown with Nebraska. What could be better, huh? Play for all the marbles, and Northwestern still gets to go to the Rose Bowl. Life ain't all bad, you know?
Not too bad.
There's our breeze blowing across the state of Texas, the last day in action of the Southwest Conference. And if you're like me, you got your favorite memory. Dick, I'm going to tell one. Back in the 40s, I was a youngster growing up in Montana. I used to hear the game of the week out of Texas, and I sent a little letter down to a fellow by the name of Doak Walker. Only time I ever wrote an athlete asking
really?
For an autograph. I've still got the picture, an old black and white postcard.
Isn't that great?
Thank you very much, Doak Walker. I still got, that's one of my prized possessions.
I've met him a couple times too. A nice man. Player. He was a great player. There you're talking about him right there, 1948. How about John David Crow? I saw his Heisman Trophy there the other day in the office here.
Yeah.
Earl Campbell, I coached against that son of a gun.
Boy, I'll tell you. 27 seconds and yellow flags come flying.
See, if they make a first down, they can stop the clock, get their field goal team on there and kick the field goal.
Ain't no field goal automatic with the Aggies this year, Coach.
Oh, but he had a good year last year, Brent. He's had two blocked this year, though. We'll give him a little credit.
Hey, Coach, last year's last year, man. You had an Aggie kicker for a while, a fellow by the name of Franklin.
Franklin.
You know what happens with those kickers sometimes.
Yeah. Yeah. He came to the league, he had as good a leg as I've ever seen. He kicked some long ones down here, too, in the 60 category.
Well, let's see. Ball brought back down to the 30. So it's third down and make it six. Slot formation is to the left for the Aggies. And Pulley gets plenty of time. Middle incomplete. Albert Connell was covered, and it's fourth down. Chris Carter all over the big play receiver of the Aggies.
The ball is so far off, neither the receiver or the defender could catch it, Brent. He has been off his game, really. I visited with him the other day, and he was very confident he was going to have a good ball game. He said the only thing they've really taken out of the ball game is they're doing less waggle action stuff. Here's the matchup, one-on-one. See, throw it. He's there. The safety comes in outside, Don. He comes in on him. They were doubling him up.
You can't go for a field goal into this wind from where the Aggies are. And there's illegal procedure again, apparently, huh?
Yeah, the Hunter Goodwin, the right tackle, moved early. For a second there, I thought he might have been forced off, but there's Goodwin right there. Good football player, Goodwin is. Watch him on tape.
The Aggies have had a half to forget offensively.
Yeah, here he is right there in the center of your screen. See him move early right there? Bracken says, hey, he moved early. Call it.
Yeah, this is going to bring it on back now to the 35-yard line with 23 seconds to go. Slot formation is to the left. Pulley. Deflected. Incomplete. Horns ball. 18 seconds. They can run out the clock and take that 6-point lead into the locker room. And R.C. Slocum has got to be disgusted with that first half offensive performance. He's not sure where to go first.
He is upset.
He'll start with the tackles and he'll move in.
Next will be the guards, then to the center, you then bet. On in the backfield.
I wouldn't be surprised if old Reveille didn't bite one of those fellas heading off the field. You know, they can't take that. And Bevo is enjoying every moment right now, but there's still a half a football left to play. And the horns get something going, and out of bounds goes Mitchell with 12 seconds to go.
Knowing Coach Makovic and the way he thinks offensively, he very seldom likes to waste the down. In command here with the wind in his back, he's thinking, I don't want to turn the ball over, do anything stupid, interception, run back for a touchdown. But still, he might just go ahead and wing one down there.
12 seconds, the wind's at his back right now. If you give up an interception right here, it ain't gonna matter with a few seconds. They're not gonna go the distance on you.
He's trying to get it down there for a field goal. He still has the wind to his back.
There's
that adds
Reveille.
7-8 there's, yards to the field goal
on,
distance.
Come on, defense. Let's get it going right there. Now, folks, look at that. Look at that beautiful dog, huh?
He doesn't look mean enough.
No, you know,
he's not in a bad
somebody
mood.
Somebody every morning, one of the cadets on game day, they gotta blow dry. They gotta scrub it, wash it, and then they blow
shampoo,
dry.
The whole works.
Oh,
you think so?
That's one spoiled puppy over there on the far sideline, folks. Second down now. 8 seconds to go. Right side, that's Adams with Mickens on him, close to the first down.
This is one of the few times in a ball game that the A&M defense will play a consistent zone coverage, and they're taking advantage of it with 4 seconds left, though. That's a long ways to go.
Yeah, doesn't matter.
With the wind to your back, might as well take a shot. He has a 61-yarder to his credit.
So here he is. Trying to catch a Texas breeze and hit a 58-yarder.
He nailed it pretty good, Brent.
Oh, it was long, but off to the right. But I'll tell you what, he had the distance.
He had the distance.
Oh, yes,
he had been good another 5 yards back. Hey, take that guy with you.
So the horns lead the Aggies by 6 at the end of the first half. John Saunders, take it away in Atlanta. We are back, and Texas leading Texas A&M. 6-0 is the score right here at the half. So Dick Vermeil, a lovely halftime ceremony, performance by the marching band of Texas A&M, and we had a little excitement here in the first half.
Yeah, you got late back here. It scared me to death.
Had to do a little politicking, you know. Here's the touchdown.
Oh, yeah, but Williams, a draw play, called at the right time. Man-to-man coverage, you're blitzing up in front. They don't see him running right up their back for the touchdown. Big play, and really the only big play so far, other than good punting.
Well, there are the numbers as far as McElroy is concerned today. He's rushed for 91, caught a pass for 20, no return yards. They've kept it out of his hands, 111 total yards, and, of course, no touchdowns. But He really is the elusive one, number 34, and he can bring it. Well, you know, we are joined by John Spagnuolo, and I know that you are certainly very well aware of his background, but some of you folks might not be. Of course, you played for the Philadelphia Eagles, but look at him, folks. I mean, huh? I mean, this was a rebel at Yale. I mean, here he is. You remember him as a tight end? Look at him. This is against Hart. This is the
triple threat. Fumble, stumble, and fall.
No, he was a good football player and played in this stadium against the Cowboys here in Dallas a number of times. Played tight end for me and then went on, played Green Bay and Seattle. And here he is. Looks a little older now, though,
doesn't he? Yeah, nice to have you with us, Big John.
Brent, keep in mind, they can do a lot with computers nowadays. I'm going to check that photograph out. Hey, very quickly, guys, I got a chance to talk to both coaches. R.C. Slocum told me he's real happy with the way his offense and defense is playing. He has no problems or concerns going into the second half. He just has to eliminate the turnovers. John Makovic, on the other hand, is concerned about his protection offensively. And as you know, Coach Ramil, against the blitz, you have to protect from the inside out. He said, we're going to straighten that out at halftime. Back upstairs, Brent.
John, what's interesting right now is I look down at the home of the 12th man. And, of course, you will see number 12 out on the field. He is far right for the kicking team. Member of the student body, one of the walk-ons. I saw about four or five youngsters over there on the right side of the bench area, and this is such a tremendous honor. This place explodes if number 12 can get down a field and make a hit. Now, the fellow they want to keep the ball out of his hands right there is Mike Adams. Now, what's interesting is Texas receiving the ball again, but remember, the Longhorns will have that wind at their back in the fourth quarter. And with the wind, Adams will take a knee, and it will come out on the 20-yard line where it will be first down. And, Dick, let's update those keys.
Well, I said they had to play better defense than they've been playing all year, Brent, and they've really done that. They have played excellent defense, and right now 156, 7 yards total offense. Get two long scoring plays. They got the one scoring play, but on a draw, we'll settle for that. Be plus in the turnover margin. They're plus three. My concern, if I were coaching University of Texas right now, we didn't get anything out of those three turnovers. You should come out with some points in those turnovers.
Dick, what about the condition of Brown's ankle after that time off? Does it stiffen up a little bit?
You bet it does. It's usually a little more sore when you come out in the third quarter.
It's the left ankle, ladies and gentlemen. The Aggies bringing some heavy blitzes on him, and he really looked gimpy on that. And Sean Mitchell with a splendid first down run, if you're a Texas fan, before Andre Williams can bring him down at the 36-yard line. That's a good, strong 17-yard run for it.
And this is an example of a defensive lineman overpowering here, knocking the offensive lineman back and creating a hole back inside. Sometimes you can be too physical on defense.
They continue to flop the cornerbacks depending on where Adams is lined up. Mickens over on the short side of the field. Adams is to the right. And now Brown looking for Adams. Deflected, incomplete. He underthrew Adams, and Dennis Allen, the free safety, stepped into the passing lane.
Boy, Dennis Allen, he's a heads-up guy. He's here in school, graduate student, very close to getting his MBA. His dad's in the Hall of Fame here, was a great football player here within this university. Taking a look at the numbers of the first half, pretty even all the way down the road here, Brent. 133, 157. Here's the glaring thing. Minus three in turnover, but Texas didn't get anything out of those points.
Now on second down and 10. Running game, and it's Williams who scored the touchdown. Run out at the 39-yard line. Gain of three, and Allen is there again for the Aggies.
They tried that counter gap play, which has really been their number one running play all year. And you would think the counter gap action might freeze those people inside just for a split second and allow the offensive lineman pulling to get some leverage on them. But A&M's defense is so quick.
Now, there's the result of all the possessions that Texas had in the first half, and a 6-0 lead and a botched extra point. Now from the shotgun and a penalty flag, the right side of the offensive line moved, and this will be against Texas. This will bring the ball back to the other side of the 35-yard line.
You know, sometimes, Brent, an offensive lineman moves when they look up and they see a different defense. That was a different defensive front. They had five down linemen, actually putting a linebacker down. You can see one, two, three, four, and five at the top of your screen. Sometimes that creates and breaks concentration. Offensive linemen looking at that a little bit differently.
Just underway here in the second half. The Horns leading the Aggies by a touchdown and a missed extra point.
Here's where you really got to be careful. This has been the down and distance situation that they have blitzed him. Now, maybe at halftime they've solved the inside gap pickup problem by bringing the guard and tackle down and putting the back on the outside rusher. We'll see, but right now it's tight man coverage, Brent.
Matt Davis into the slot. Adams out wide to the left. Mickens is locked up on him, and they run, and a crushing tackle by Reggie Brown, the linebacker from Austin. A homecoming for Reggie against the Horns. Wow.
And he is a player. 4-4-7 in the 40, 32 vertical jump. And early in the game, you were talking about guys' strength. This guy is as strong as most of the defensive linemen, but not nearly as big. He can play.
Mark Schultes had some of his problems. The Aggies put on good pressure several times. They'll try to set a return this time on him. Fair catch, and Mickens covers it up at the 32-yard line. So it will be the Aggies' first possession of the second half. They've won 31 straight here at Kyle Field. Well, it's been a long time since the Horns have tasted a W against the Aggies. Texas A&M has won 10 of their last 11 versus Texas, including four in a row. And now Pulley, who has beaten them three straight times, bring the Aggies up, and on a rolling first down, fires complete for about 10 yards to Chris Sanders, another player from Austin.
He did a real nice job on that. Here we were talking about early in the game, the victory keys. Keep the running back receiving yards to a minimum. 6 yards, that's misleading. They really haven't gone to him very much. Do a good job offensively on first down. They're not doing a good first down job. Win the battle in the kicking game. No points in the kicking game, but they have won the battle in the kicking game.
They did a good job on this first down. They got 10 yards here, out to the 43-yard line. McElroy. He's their wonderful tailback off a play fake. Pulling under pressure. High. Intercepted at the 49. The Horns with a turnover. Jason Reeves. That's the fourth Aggie turnover of the game.
Minus four. Normally you lose when you're minus one. Minus four. You're just really playing losing football. Play action. They're going to run the draw. Try to screen rather and try to get to him. He just throws it up too high again. He's throwing the ball high, means he's leaning back, staying on his back foot, not coming through with the throw. He had just a beautiful job there by Jason Reeves.
Wayne McGarrity, redshirt freshman.
Four turnovers.
Checks in to the backfield for the Horns. He and Ricky Williams are the running backs. They now split. Williams is to the right. And Brown rifling one to the left sideline, complete out of bounds for 11 yards and a first down. Justin McLemore.
You know, and James Brown is limping just a little bit right now as he moves around down there in the field. See him hobbling right now, Brent? He's on good five-step drop, plant and throw in rhythm to the right side of your screen. He knew where he was going. He could pre-snap read the coverage. He knew where he wanted to go with the ball.
Yeah, it is possible what we talked about. We have watched him ever since he came back from the 15-minute intermission. Actually, it's more like 20, isn't it? First down. Now the ball is inside the Aggies' 40-yard line. They'll hand it to Williams. Williams looks for a crease, powers his way to the 30-yard line, and an 8-yard gain. Typhoon McMullen.
Big boost to Monty, the backside tackle, and Dan Neal, the offensive guard, pulled around on their counter. But first off, they get a good block at the point of attack. 74, 69, they seal. Boom, oh, boost, they gave him a boost. They, a nice lunch, nice job. Bustamante.
Coach likes that block.
Oh, and I like that name.
Second down, need two. Horns trying to mount it again with this running game. Gutty performance by a limping quarterback. The hand, it is a first down inside by Ricky Williams, who, in case you were not with us in the first half, he scored the touchdown. He's under scholarship being paid for by the Philadelphia Phillies, a baseball prospect, and he's moving the chains here with this running game.
We're taking another look at Big Bustamante come off the ball in a zone blocking principle and turn the defender the outside. Now, they were very concerned about him coming into the game, Bustamante, that's from a pass protection standpoint, not from a run standpoint.
Now Williams is back into the fullback position. He alternates. They run Mitchell to the 21-yard line and 3 yards, and another Mitchell, Blandon, the junior, brings him down for the Aggies.
What a great junior college transfer John Mitchell is. You know, Brent, he always wanted to come here, Sean did. And he really said, hey, he was recruited another place. I'm coming here. And he paid the price. Went to junior college, worked his way in, got his grades, and here he is running.
For the Texas Longhorns, back in Austin, J.C. transfer, second down and 7. With the back split, Brown throws it up in the air, picked off, intercepted at the 6. He threw it up for grabs, under pressure from the blitz, and free safety, Dennis Allen intercepted it.
Again, Phil Blanett coming with the blitz, the defensive coordinator, good call. You know, you don't want a quarterback to do that. Gosh, throws it up down the hole late, hoping to make the big play. But if you are going to turn the ball over as a quarterback, turn it over here where they have 94 yards to go. Bad decision, bad decision.
Adams, the intended receiver, number 83, and now Allen turns it over, and John Makovic is telling Brown, don't give him a chance down in there. We were doing well. We had a chance. But the Aggies, with the wind at their back at 11:24, McElroy, the running back, behind Pulley. That's the fullback, Smith, on the left wing. In motion. McElroy made the most out of that. Took his time and patiently picked his way for 3 yards.
This Texas defense has really played beyond my expectation. I studied them on tape. They started out real shake early in the year, but they came on strong. And this time they have a good block by the fullback coming right up into the hole, but he was not able to cut back into the hole. He cut to the outside.
Second down and 7. McElroy, there's Smith the blocker, and now they're using him on that left wing like an H-back, bringing him back in motion, and McElroy is jumped by Akins, number 96, another 300-pounder, sophomore Chris Akins.
You know, he lost 30 pounds to be a better football player. He's the strongest man on the team. Strength coach Rock Gillickson told me that this guy is a great, great kid to coach. And Gary Darnell says, I've never coached a guy I enjoy coaching more than this guy.
As a result of Akin's play, coach, it's 3rd and 9. Shotgun look for Pulling. And it's whistled before the snap.
You know, talking about how strong Akins is, he bench presses 500 pounds. Squat 730.
Boy, the Aggies are making too many mistakes. They were plagued by turnovers and false starts in the first half. Now they make another one. And if they don't bail out on this, this is a perilous spot from
ball
which to
start,
punt the ball.
Offense, still 3rd down.
Look at the penalties. Right now, they're almost at their average. They're just slightly over their average penalties for the game, Brent.
It's 3rd and 12 right now for Pulling and the Aggies. The horns will try to account for McElroy. He's got it in the middle. McElroy dancing. And McElroy out to the 11. That's not a first down, but that is a very important run. The kicker does not have to stand in the back of his end zone now.
You know, when you give him the ball attacking the line of scrimmage, now this is a draw play, a quick hitting draw. Sits in there, they give it to him, he's going right to the line of scrimmage, looking for the point, then he shakes and breaks, gets upfield like that, but breathing room for the punter. And Sean Terry has done a great job punting all day.
He's standing just inside his end zone. Adams is back deep. Low, and now Adams with a chance. Great coverage by A&M. And Adams lets it roll dead. I mean, the outside defender that time on that punt team was down in a hurry.
He must have come over here from the track team.
That's Michael Price, who buried that ball in the first half at the 1 yard line. What another play by 40. We'll be right back.
It's not true that Don King is thinking about bringing a fight down here to Texas. John Spagnuolo.
Brent, as James Brown, the quarterback, as his left ankle continues to deteriorate in this football game from all the pounding he's been taking, don't be surprised to see Texas use the shotgun formation more. They have some plays worked in, some running plays that they'll be able to work out of the shotgun. It'll take that pressure off the left ankle.
Well, that's true. Then they do have, they have a trap out of the shotgun, a shuffle pass out of the shotgun.
They bring him up underneath center right now.
Five down linemen.
And they split Mitchell and Williams in the backfield. And this is Williams cutting back to the left, and he was able to beat the first defender and get to the 40-yard line. Reggie Brown is there to make the stop.
See, they're in five down linemen playing man-to-man with a free safety in that situation. They've been doing that a lot on first down. I wouldn't be surprised to see Coach Makovic come with that five-step drop throwing game on first down.
And that was Dat Wynn, who couldn't wrap him up. The first defender, number nine, who relays the defense to the Aggies. And if you want to watch a talented defense, just watch Texas A&M with this great speed. And two collide, and that opens the way. Two defenders hit each other back here at the 35-yard line, and that opens the way for the running back. Typho McMullen, the strong side safety, got himself locked up with Reggie Brown, and neither of them could make the play.
Ricky Williams, the fullback, did a real nice job. Here he is, a true freshman, running the ball efficiently. That time he got a cut-down block at the point. It allowed the running back to get outside. Nice job by Ricky.
And Dick Mitchell takes a breather right now. So McGarity, a redshirt freshman from San Antonio, splits off with Williams. Williams is to the left of the offense in the backfield.
Five down people again. They're in man coverage.
And Brown, ISO. Did they call it incomplete? They said he didn't have it going out of bounds on that far side. It looked like, for a moment, McLemore had something going. But Andre Williams up with the play. And remember, he's been filling in for Donovan Greer, who's been injured over there on that corner. So they're looking that way.
Did a real tight coverage. The ball was thrown where it ought to be thrown, over to the outside and away from the defender. He just couldn't hang on to the ball, and you have to credit Andre Williams.
Now they send Sean Mitchell back onto the field. Remember, he's an outstanding receiver out of the backfield. They also have, offensively, Pat Fitzgerald, the tight end. It is second down and 10. They sweep left. And Mitchell is eaten up by the Aggie defense at the 45. This will put Texas in third and long.
Really hard to run that type of play, slow hitting play, against the five down linemen by putting those linebackers down. Brent, there's really no gaps in there. You'll see what I'm talking about here. One here, two here, three here, four here, five here. Not a lot of places to run. Then they have three other people up there. That's an eight-man front. Tough to find a place to run. Got to throw against that.
Into the wind. Texas, third and nine. And the shotgun look.
Delayed blitz.
Middle, incomplete. Adams with Mickens on him. Couldn't get over in time. And Brown took a hit on the blitz as Reggie Brown and Keith Mitchell both were coming.
What's tough about that is they delayed the sixth rusher on that. The blitz guy from the inside, you'll see him flash from the right side of your screen. He didn't come initially. He came late and got there. But boy, that's tough to pick up if a running back is assigned to him and he doesn't come initially.
Now a punt play on fourth down. The Aggies in the first half were able to pressure Schultes a couple of times. They're still content to sit in here, and this one out of bounds in good shape. That ball's gonna be marked at the 16-yard line. Good job by Schultes that time. 7:30 to go. Texas A&M still being shut out. CFA College Football on ABC, brought to you by Chevrolet Trucks. When you want a haul of Bevo, it's the truck for you. And calcium-rich Tums. Tums helps wipe out heartburn and gives you calcium.
Look, he's got a little chew in his mouth there.
Yes, sir. Those Chevy trucks are good for moving that livestock around, partner. Yeah. And there's Reveille saying, oh,
I want equal
air.
Time. I want equal time.
Yeah, he said,
I got all dressed up for this thing, and you're not putting me on? What do you mean? I went to the hairdresser?
All right. 6-0 now. Aggies trying to come out. Pulling off a play fake and a foot race, and he's got the tight end, Bradley, over here to the 34-yard line. Well-conceived little play for about 17 yards.
Those
and
things.
Reeves gets over on Clay. That's Hayward Clay now. Let's get the right tight end here.
Action here, tight end here, freeze, then come out late. Really tough on the defenders. See, make the fake, comes out there, comes out on the waggle action, throws it. Nice job of execution and faking. Good poise by Corey Pullock.
Now, Dick, it's the top of the hour right now. 7:16 to go in the third quarter. And Texas leading Texas A&M. 6-0 is the score. This is a first down. And Pulling off another fake goes right side.
Got him.
Got it. At the 35-yard line, Aaron Oliver. And a penalty flag is down. Back at the 24-yard line, there's a penalty flag down. Hold on. It's against the horns. It counts.
I think they roughed the passer right here. Yeah. That's not good football. I think that's a dumb move by Brakin right there. Man, he really came up behind him. You recognize that Oliver name. His dad, Al Oliver, the old great Major League Baseball player, now living in Columbus, Ohio. Makovic says, my gosh. Ah, that's dumb football. Tony Brackens has been playing well all day and comes up with that play.
Now Pulling, straightening it out with Doyle Jackson, saying, let's just tack the 15 on the end of the game. and the coach Mack is over there saying, what, the game's not good enough for you?
Make it a note. Coach Slocum.
Personal foul by the defense is declined. First down.
So the ball will be put at the 36-yard line. And now this is a big stand for the Longhorn defense. It's a 32-yard gain. McElroy is the running back. Smith is the fullback. McElroy on a draw into the middle, and he powers across the 30-yard line.
Nice job of combination blocking with the fullback and the backside guard. Steve McKinney pulled around. The fullback kicked out. The guard pulled up into the hole. Real good execution here. Fullback right here going to kick out. The guard comes around. Does a nice job on it. Here he goes. The guard right there. Shaboom! There's a nice block. Fullback right there. Good teamwork on the two.
And they hurry and set a trick formation. And there is Pulling lateraling to McElroy. And McElroy down the sideline to the 20-yard line. A legal play as Pulling goes up to the line of scrimmage and is able to shovel it right to McElroy behind the shifting offensive line. Very well conceived. First down now for the Aggies at the 21-yard line and on the drive.
Here it is. Sometimes a play like that can really shake you up, too. See, defense not set like that. Offense out there looks like a big screen, a wall of maroon jerseys out there.
McElroy directly behind Pulling. Another hole on the right as he dances through it now. And a penalty flag comes down after the tackle at the 16-yard line.
Oh, my gosh, guys. See, again, he's attacking the line of scrimmage to the right side of your screen. You get good blocking at the point here on the right side, and he goes, look at those, that base. And then he sees that hole, and he's back up in there. Maybe shaking just a little too much. Accelerate a little more, young man. Here, low from behind, bang, bang. Goes to the right, up through the hole. He can make you miss.
Now it's a first down, and the ball is inside the 10-yard line. This is first and goal for the Aggies from the 8-yard line. On that last replay, there was just a little bit of Barry Sanders in that move by McElroy. That quick hump off to the side. That's why he is so highly valued by everyone. And Sir Parker now will give him a breather. He's in the backfield. Parker smashes to the 4-yard line, and it'll be second and goal. Carter making the stop for the Horns.
Boy, I'm impressed with the blocking of the big fullback, Detron Smith. He has good fundamentals. Coach Ken Rucker's done a nice job of coaching him. He really nails that point of attack. He takes a load with him, Brent. He can move you out of the hole.
And now they loaded up, Dick, with another fullback. Mark Broyles out of Tyler, Texas, also checks into that backfield. So they've got two fullbacks in there.
Equally good blocker, too.
And McElroy returns. You would think now on second and goal, they would be setting the extra blocking and give it to 34 and see if he can get it to the end zone for 6. Play fake. Pulling's going to roll on it. Pulling back in the end zone. No good. Incomplete.
Inches, inches, inches.
Broyles, the intended receiver. And that sets up third and goal.
Real good coverage here. You'll see him come off and go to the corner right there with play action. So many times this year, we've seen this type of play. Fake the defense out, but it doesn't. Safety gets in there. The ball is thrown well. It's just right out there off the fingers. Really close. Robert Crenshaw in the coverage here, number 25. Back up safety.
Sir Parker in the backfield behind Smith. Third down and goal for the Aggies, trailing it by 6. 5 minutes left in the third quarter. Sir Parker is hit in its fourth and goal. Decision time for Slocum. Akins makes the stop defensively, and here comes the field goal team. Here comes Kyle Bryant. And keep in mind, we have seen fakes this year, and we've seen them late in the going. Now, Bryant has struggled with his kicking this year. They do trail it only by 6. That's also something to keep in mind right now. And Slocum might want to get on the board.
He's missed one in his career from this distance, Brent. As you said, he has struggled this year, missed one of 2 from this distance this year.
It's a 20-yarder. The backup quarterback, Case, is the holder now for the Aggies. The kick is up, and he slaps it through. So it's a 3-point difference right now.
Well, Gary Darnell, defensive coordinator, and the rest of the defensive staff have to be pretty pleased with that inside the goal line area defense, Brent. That's, this is a good football team down in that area. They've been successful all year down inside that 10-yard line area.
Dick, are you surprised, like I am, that they didn't put the ball in McElroy's hands down there inside the 5-yard line at some point?
Well, you know my philosophy. When in doubt and running a big play, you always give the ball to your best football player. But they have a lot of confidence in this Sir Parker. They think he's going to be a great football player.
There's the SEC Championship presented by Dr. Pepper a little bit later. Starts tonight at 7:30. It's Florida and Arkansas. The Gators just one win away from taking on Nebraska in the Fiesta Bowl.
It's going to be interesting to see how they can play coming off the big one last week. You know, they play a big game and then have to jump right back in and play another big game. That's tough, regardless of how good you are.
Well, we remember Danny Ford when he was up in Clemson. The Gators will know they were in a football game. They're going to get hit tonight. There's no question about that. The only question about Arkansas is whether or not the defensive backfield can hold up against those talented wide receivers. Just listen up when Keith Jackson's bringing the call to you. Watch the middle of the defense. I have never seen a college coach exploit the middle deep like Steve Spurrier does. You better bring a ton of safeties to show up when you take on the Gators. Fun and gun, it's fun if you ain't on defense. Let me tell you.
You said it correctly there.
Now Bryant kicking it off. We've got a field goal difference right now. It's 6-3. Horns will get the ball back. And they put it in Adams' hands. And
coverage.
Push him at the 21-yard line.
Excellent coverage. Their special teams are very good.
Now McElroy is over here at the sideline, and he was a little bit upset, we are told, from down below when he came over to the sideline. And the fact that they didn't put the ball in his hands, I'd say, come on, 34, decide it for us. You got us down here.
Yeah, but, you know, he can get upset if he wants, but his scholarship doesn't give him the right to call the plays.
Your coaches are all alike. First down and 10 now. Williams on a cutback into the middle, and Williams breaks free. Williams, oh, Rusty, what a run, midfield, and Williams is out of bounds at the 35-yard line. Ricky Williams.
Again, it was Dan Neal and the Bustamante coming over from the right side on the counter action, and then just excellent, excellent running. You'll see the guard pull here. You'll see the tackle pull and lead through. But, yeah, they did a job, but the running back really did the job. Nice blocker. Excellent skills right here. Look at the footwork right there. Stiff arm, more footwork. Excellent running. He is a true freshman from Patrick Henry High School in San Diego. How'd they ever let him get out of the state? Excellent.
First down, the ball to 35 after the 44-yard run by Williams. And that was Brandon Mitchell making the big play on Ricky that time. I'm sort of surprised they brought him right back after that dandy 44-yarder. He's now rushed for 89 yards on the day, and now he goes off.
You know, we give credit to those two big linemen pulling, but the tight ends, Pat Fitzgerald and Steve Bradley, have to block down at that play and do a good job, and that's what they're doing to allow the guard and the tackle to get around that point.
3.5 minutes, a long field goal by Dawson, if it came to that, would be into a treacherous wind. The Horns need to get something going. And a beautiful spinning move by Mitchell. Number 3 spins, and he's out of bounds on the Aggie side. The ball will be marked down there right around the 30-yard line.
You know, the tight end, I just mentioned Pat Fitzgerald did a nice job on that. See, he has to collapse the corner and block down to allow those guards and tackles to get around like that. There's big Fitzgerald, academic All-American, this guy, a bright young man. Here he is right here. You'll see him block down here. Bang, gets a block down here. Good job.
It is 3rd and 5 for Brown and the Horns. Big play for the Aggie defense.
Showing blitz.
Brown's got time. High, Adams got it inside the 20. He was able to hang on that time. That's a first down, and that's a monster play.
They had blitz coverage on. They ran the right pattern. McAvick making the next call, staying calm, not celebrating with the success of that play. Got the ball off. Heavy, heavy pressure. Safety's coming. Linebacker's coming. Throws it to the outside. He gets out of the way. He doesn't want his ankle stepped on. There it is. Beautiful concentration there by Mike Adams, number 83.
That is their first 3rd down conversion of the day. If you're a Texas fan, could not have come at a better time. Brown, Gimpy and all, incomplete. This will be 2nd and 10. You know, when you go back to that scene moments ago, you were looking at two of the best athletes on the field. Adams was going up, trying to maintain concentration and make the catch. Mickens, number 24, was all over him with good coverage on that far side. It was just one great performer, a little bit better than the other one that time. And now it is 2nd and 10.
They like to get in slot formations down here in the red zone, Brent, and run the slot man to the corner and the outside guy underneath. Here they're coming.
And on Williams as a gap. Williams turns the corner, dives for the end zone, and Williams is out very close at the 1-yard line. It is Ricky Williams.
They caught him quick counting, Brent. They went on a quick count. Defense wasn't really set. Made the blocks a little bit easier. You don't have to move people. Here, see, the defense is not set. They block down. Here comes Neal. Here comes Bustamante. No one there to force it. They weren't ready to play football. Good job. Good use of cadence.
Now Williams is over 100 yards. And it's 1st and goal for the Horns. Up over the top. And it'll be 2nd down and goal. No signal down there yet. That was big Brandon Mitchell in the middle there defensively. McGarrity in that backfield for Coach Makovic and the Horns. 2.5 minutes to go. McGarrity and Williams are your running backs. Brown with that tender left ankle, so you wonder whether or not he would ever think about keeping it on a quarterback sneak down here. It would be a long yard for him. Williams is hit beautifully by 95, Edward Jasper.
Great penetration, poor blocking by the offensive line. Goal line, you always protect your inside gap. They did not protect the inside gap. You'll see it right here. Penetration. There he goes. He slants right through it. Boy, what quickness. He did that same thing in the first quarter and got in there, Brent.
Third down now. And remember, with Brown's injured left ankle, it cuts down his mobility. He cannot roll against the side and choose the option. Ricky Williams, Feeberger, one of his blockers. And a timeout has been called by Texas. Brown's coming over the sideline. A timeout for the Horns, facing a third and goal. The ball is at the 2-yard line. This is tomorrow now on 8 at 8, 7 Central, right here. That's after the videos on ABC. After 82 years, the Southwest Conference brings down the curtain today. Texas and Texas A&M playing for the championship and the big bucks in a Tier 1 Alliance Bowl. Think about this, ladies and gentlemen. The last Southwest Conference championship, that's bragging rights for a long, long time. And now the Horns will come out third down and goal.
The big thing here from a quarterback standpoint on the sideline, I'm sure it was mentioned, if we throw it, it's not there. You throw it out of the back to end zone. Don't throw any bad throw.
Williams is the running back. He's set deep in the eye. They'll try and touchdown. He'll walk in. Huge hole on the right side.
Another variation of the counter. Just a different formation with different people doing it. Excellent call.
Now, you would think with this score that they'd go for two, having missed one extra point. They will set up and attempt the two-point conversion. Lots of excitement Bevo showing.
They're going to go back to kick it, Brent.
They have changed their mind.
Up by 9. You kick it.
And they're up by 9. This would put them up by 10. And remember, a tie would send Texas to the Tier 1 Alliance Bowl. So this number does not put the Longhorns at high risk as of right now. 13-3, a 10-point lead. They get the wind at their back in the last quarter. So James Brown, tender ankle and all, is able to hook up some sweet music and bring the Horns down the field for a score. Do it for me, James. So there you are, and back in Austin, sweet music indeed. This would spark a major celebration if the Horns can come in here and beat their arch rivals. They have lost, remember, 10 of the last 11, including 4 in a row. John Makovic has never beaten R.C. Slocum as head coach of the Horns. And there you can see it. Florida will go for the Fiesta tonight. The Orange Bowl, the Nokia Sugar Bowl, still on the line. The winner or if it's a tie, then it's Texas. So there's still a lot of goodies out there. High bouncing kick. Keep it out of McElroy's hands. And the Aggies will put it in play from the 32 as Eric Bernard returns Dawson's kickoff.
There's a price you pay for those kind of kickoffs. Yes, you don't get the ball in the great returner's hand, but here you are on the 33-yard line.
Now, Dick, the coach, Darnell, don't we remember him calling shots at Notre Dame?
Notre Dame, you bet. And he's called an excellent game today. He's called a great game and prepared a great defensive game plan. And they didn't change their defenses that much, really. They just squared away. They wanted to squeeze the running lanes. Right, there's Gary Darnell right there. They wanted to make sure they maintain the discipline of their defensive line technique so they don't give McElmore room to run up inside there.
Leland McElroy doesn't need much daylight. He'll find that crease. Off a fake to him. Pulling deep down the middle. That's Connell double team. Incomplete. So the safety rotated over to help the corner. Allen was there with Thomas, and there was no chance.
But it does shake him up when you go with that. You know, you take a shot at that, trying to get in there behind the safety with play action passing. He gets it out. He throws it out there any shorter, and it's picked up. Three jerseys on him, though.
Second down and 10. It's 13-3, Texas. McElroy dances right, finds a hole. Boy, I tell you what, watching that run, you got to say to yourself, oh, baby, inside that five-yard line, number 34 is never, ever leaving the field, if I'm talking to you down there anyway.
And the other thing with this guy running, there's no such thing as the defined point of attack. He starts here to the left, gets a nice block by the fullback. He didn't like it there. There's another hole. I'll run there. If they ran that same play 15 times in a row, he'd put it in the end zone, and they'd keep making first downs.
Where is Tim like Biaka Batuka?
Hey, that's what they did, didn't they?
Absolutely.
They did it out of two tight ends and two wide outs, but still not a bad idea.
First down and 10. The Aggies at the 43.
Reverse.
Around, Connell has got the handoff, and the horns are not fooled a bit. Robert Reed, the senior, number 40, he wasn't fooled, and Jason Reeves joined him.
Good, good discipline. Now, linebacker coaches really love that. Dan Rocco coaches the linebackers. You know, it's your responsibility as a coach to discipline those techniques and make sure they do what they do it in pressure times. And that time, Mr. Reed did it perfect.
Second down and 13 as a result of that loss. Now McElroy, and he crushes out to the 47-yard line.
What do you think, huh? Not too bad a way to go, is it?
No.
If you got a guy who can run, give him the ball and let him run it the direction that he has to score.
Might as well use him today. You may not have him next year.
That's right. Plus, he's been banged up, so this may be one of the few opportunities they really had to strap it on and let him go.
And we'll return with the final quarter between Texas and Texas A&M after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Go get him, Bebo.
All right, BC, go out for a long one.
Okay. You know, CompUSA is almost as big as a football field.
Well, 5,000 computer products take up a lot of... You didn't break the compact 7180 Pentium desktop PC with 8 megabytes of RAM, a 1.2 gigabyte hard drive, and more, did you?
Or the compact 100 megahertz Pentium processor PC with 8 megabytes of RAM, a quad-speed CD-ROM drive, and more.
Heads up, PC. Are you okay?
Yeah, but Ed here in corporate sales is going to have quite a lump.
15 minutes to go, and Texas with a 10-point lead. The Aggies with the ball, third down and 6 yards, and now a chance to compare some great running backs with what McElroy has accomplished in his 3 years here. Are you wondering about Barry Sanders? Look at his freshman year at Oklahoma State. Well, there was a fellow by the name of Thurman Thomas who was on that Cowboy team, as I recall. Pretty impressive numbers, and the ankle injury has resulted in low numbers this season. Now with split backs and pulling. Left side, first down, and almost a big one. Chris Sanders broke free and had an alley on that far far side. But then Trey Thomas, the junior from Sugar Land, Texas, was able to save the moment over there.
I'll tell you what really saved the moment. They blitzed him. The horns blitzed him, and the pass protection was perfect. They picked up everybody fundamentally sound and allowed him to get that ball off.
Aggies working against the wind. And pulling, rolling to the right. Fires it complete to Oliver, who is whacked at the 32 by Westbrook. So after three, these are the numbers with the horns up by 10.
Well, Texas really jumped in that third quarter. Look at the rushing yards now, 165 yards. And we were talking about they'd been running well but didn't do well in the first half. Here they are up to 165. They're pretty balanced in total offense. But when you're plus three, you've got a big edge.
Second down and two. Smith, the fullback, blocks for McElroy, and McElroy is met. Tyson King, number 50, took him on in the hole that time.
He really did a nice job of stepping up in there. See, if the linebacker gets up in the hole, he fills part of the hole. Less room for the running back to cut either way. Nice job by young King. Four-time on the athletic director's honor roll, smart student. Look at the comparison here. Texas first half, 117 second.
All right, here we come to third and one. Smith, the fullback, an outstanding blocker, leads McElroy for the first down. Now that's first down to the 28-yard line.
You know, outstanding blocker, you used that term. You've heard me mention that. Deton Smith, number 44 this time, really did a nice job of going through the point of attack. You'll see him appear from the left side of your screen. He goes in, 44, follow him, bang! Look at nice body position, nice job. He creates the hole, first down.
McElroy, a couple of yards with Robert Crenshaw there.
You know, being this high and looking down, it looks like every time he touches the ball, he's about ready to squirt through some little area there. Crenshaw limping off the field. He's a backup safety.
So that Rice-Houston game actually will be the final Southwest Conference game unfolding up in Houston, because this one will end earlier than that. Second down at 10, and Pulling.
A little early.
No question, Carter
got there early.
Now he's claiming the ball was deflected or something, and he had a free shot at the back, but that's not going to carry much weight.
I didn't see it get deflected.
Now, the sideline is saying it was deflected. Yes, it was.
Hey,
what a great play by Carter.
Heads up, guy.
What a great play by Carter. He saw that it was deflected, and he knew the rule perfectly.
That's when you have bright people in the secondary that can adjust after the snap. He came into this program in the upper 1.5% of his high school class. He's a bright kid, and he makes a bright decision right there.
Yeah, Robert Reed in that replay was able to get a hand up in time. Now this is third and 10. The Aggies have got really two downs to get 10 yards. A tie doesn't do Texas A&M any good. They need the W. And Pulling down the middle. And there's a penalty flag. Chris Sanders, there may have been a face mask tacked on.
Boy, real nice throw. What a great time to come up with a great throw. Slot formation to the right side of your screen. He comes right down in the middle of it. Quarterback gets good protection. He sets up. He's looking down the hole. Coverage defied. Fires it right where he has to. Nice job there.
There's the face mask, it looked like.
What a nice time to come up with a big throw. That's a difficult throw, Brent.
That's just basically interference.
The defense,
you know, when I saw the replay, I did not see the hand in on the face mask.
I'm older than you. I don't see as well.
First and 10. The ball is at the 12-yard line. McElroy, nothing doing that time because of Shane Rink.
He's made a few plays today. Big shame.
The 13th play in this drive for the Aggies coming up right now. They could get a first down, a first and goal, but they have to get inside the 2 yard line. R.C. Slocum and the Aggies are trailing it by 10. Big toss to McElroy. Pulling fires. Incomplete. It'll be third down and 8 yards from the 11-yard line. Bryant Westbrook, a very physical young defensive back over on that side.
And when you're down there deep in your red zone area, you can play physical as long as you don't get there too early, because you don't have much room to defend. You don't have to back up very far. Playing with great confidence at that corner position.
Pulig is looking over at Slocum's sideline to see what the play is that comes down from up above. That's our situation. 11:30 to go. It's 13-3 Texas. Pulling with time.
Oh, complete.
Oh, Westbrook. And a penalty flag comes flying. A late flag is thrown from the side. And if that's against Westbrook, it's going to be a first down. It's against the Horns.
Here it comes. Wow.
I didn't see any penalty. I just saw great contact.
Westbrook pleading his case. John Spagnuolo.
Well, the penalty against Texas there is for taunting. You know, a rule put in early in the year after that hit by Westbrook. He strutted a little bit, and that's where they call the unsportsmanlike, Brent. Don't kill the messenger.
No, just shoot the official. Holy mackerel. Woo! Absolutely ridiculous.
Well, we'll call a timeout and sort this out. They're showing 4th and 3. We'll be right back. All right, we're going to let you be the judge on this now. Watch Westbrook after the hit. It's incomplete. Now watch afterwards. Would you call this? It's your call. The flag did come late. Now, normally, this is a 15-yard penalty, but because of where the ball was at the 10-yard line, it's half the distance. So it is not a first down. It has left them with a 4th and 3. And R.C. Slocum was questioning the officials about whether or not it should be a first down, but it's not automatic. So, if they kick this field goal, Kyle Bryant with a 22-yarder. Stormy Case, the backup quarterback, is the holder. And they go ahead, and they kick the field goal. So 13-6. Now remember what Coach Slocum is thinking. If he gets a touchdown, he'll go for 2 and the win then. Remember, a tie would send the Horns to Miami or New Orleans. A&M must win it.
Bit.
11:30 to go, and Texas leading Texas A&M 13-6. Kyle Bryant, who has hit 2 field goals today, and the 12th man is ready to come down the field again. Wouldn't you love to see the 12th man, the last guy to beat? Adams is there, he's dancing, he makes all the moves, and the 12th man gets it done. If you're a Longhorn fan, you're throwing things at the TV set right now. Let me say that.
I wonder if they've ever had a touchdown returned against them with a 12th man in there.
Yeah, I'll tell you that story in a minute, too. They're keeping it out of Adams' hands. Great. Yeah, that's a penalty.
Decision.
That was a good decision by that return man to let it go at the last instant over there. That was a very, very wise decision. Well, the 12th man story is this, Dick. In the old days, I believe back when Jackie Sherrill, everybody who came down the field was a 12th. Everybody was a walk-on. You sent them all down, and they were doing good, and they were doing home games, but you couldn't travel them, remember. So they might be on the road for three or four games, and those kids wouldn't get to cover kickoffs. So lo and behold, someone picks one up against them and goes the distance for the kickoff. So, yeah, let's just use one guy from now on.
Smart coaching. Good decision maker there.
And isn't that a wonderful tradition? I mean, is anything any better than that? Sure. Having a walk-on stand over here and come down the field on a kickoff? I don't think there's a team in the country that is any closer to its student body than they are here at Texas A&M. It's a delight to see. Now, Ricky Williams is the running back. And he has been outstanding today. Fake to him, and Brown's gonna take off and go down. Now, ordinarily he would not, but with that injured ankle, the coaches have told him, just take it on down. We do not want you running in the open field and risk injuring that ankle right now. It's 13-6. How about those two fellas, huh? Jack Nicklaus and Tom Watson. I'll tell you what, folks. I know a little bit about this one. The Shell's Wonderful World of Golf is tomorrow at 2:30 Eastern. You want to watch it. If you want to see these two go at it again, there's some great drama. And then the J.C. Penney Classic, the final round. I think I saw Laura Davies and Mark McCumber were the leaders after yesterday's round when I was glancing through the paper today.
Penalty against the horns. This is a drive that they should go out there and try to eat up some clock time, you know.
Second down and 13. 31 straight victories at Kyle Field. Now trailing the horns by 7, needing a win. A tie doesn't make it.
5 down people.
And a nice move by Sean Mitchell.
See, they're putting a weak side linebacker down in a 3-point stance over the guard and rushing 5 people, playing man-to-man with a free safety. So they ran over at that weak side linebacker down in a 3-point stance.
The Aggies have done an outstanding job of bottling up Pat Fitzgerald, number 81, at the line of scrimmage. If you had a 3rd and 9 and you needed a big play receiver and you were Texas, you'd try to find Fitzgerald, but he's been unable to get himself open. They send him in motion. They sprint him out to the right side. Brown fires incomplete.
There's pass interference too, right?
And there it is. There's a first down. Andre Williams.
I saw 2 people shoving. I saw 1 defender shoving. I saw 1 offensive player shoving. Going to discuss this one. Yeah.
Let him offset.
RC can't believe that, but I saw that from up here. You know, they in the game plan, Brent, they wanted to try to get the ball to a back out of the backfield. Now, they just sent Wayne McGarrity in there, number 8. I wouldn't be surprised. This is the time they try to get it to him for that first down out of the backfield.
Adams goes to the right, and Mickens takes him one-on-one. McGarrity and Williams split in the backfield.
5 rushers again.
Fitzgerald slants out from the right. Brown fires a diving reception. Adams was coming for it.
across midfield.
Did he rifle that? He got the kind of coverage he wanted, meaning tight man-to-man. The slant pattern thrown perfectly is really tough to defense without any underneath coverage. If people are playing man-to-man and covering their people out, you open it up from the inside out. Three-step drop, one, two, three, set up, and let it go. He rifled that thing in there. Excellent throw, beautiful hands, tough to defense.
A major league catch by Mike Adams, a 16-yard gain, and a first down. And Sean Mitchell dances his way to the 41, and now the Horns are trying to put the Aggies away.
That's the advantage of tossing the ball deep to a good running back, because he gets it in his hands quickly. He was supposed to go outside, but he got it so quick, the defense stretched. He ran a little counter just with his own running ability.
We know that Texas A&M knows how to win. And the big question about the Horns, do they know how to close the door? Second down now in the fourth quarter. Brown, gimpy ankle, throws back at the screen over here on this side. And Williams inside the 20 to the 19-yard line.
Boy, that really breaks your discipline sometime. When you start the action, you make the fake, and then you come back and screen away from the action. Here's the fake, come back, rolling right. Now he's gonna turn and screen back. Defense, good pursuit defense. Offensive lineman just sitting out there. Hey, they're looking for somebody to hit. They can't find anybody.
Did you see Mickens come off of Adams and come up there and square up? What an outstanding defensive back he is. He goes one-on-one as he has all day with Adams. And they run it in that direction with Williams. Williams, Mickens is there again at the 13-yard line along with Mitchell.
Big Dan Neal, the offensive right guard, pulled over there on that counter along with Bustamante. And again, they did a good job running the counter, this time to the weak side.
Big, very big. Mickens is down. Being tended to, he'll have to come out on this play. As we say that, you know the information's going over to Coach Makovic on that far side. He has taken Adams one-on-one all game long. And now Makovic and the assistants, they have conferred from upstairs. They're going to bring Brown over to the side. Sean Horn comes onto the field, number 21. He will replace Mickens. Out of El Paso, you know, in high school, he was one of the best offensive players down there. You folks are great football fans down in El Paso are certainly aware of that. This young man could have done it either way, and he is certainly one of the best cover cornerbacks that we have seen all season. I can't remember watching anybody who's gone one-on-one. It looks like the end of the play goes down.
And they ask him to go one-on-one about 70% of the ball game. I mean, so he's challenged all the time. Tough young man. John may think here, two downs for the first down rather than trying to get it on one pass.
Now Horn creeping up to that right corner. You can see 21 who just checked into the game. And they run Williams to the 9-yard line on second down. They needed to get close to the 8-yard line for a first down.
They got close. Offensive line that time, Corby Brooks and Ryan Feeberger. John Elmore did a real good job of coming off the ball.
Larry Walker into the game on third and one. Mickens is still out. McLemore, and Horn locks up with him. So Adams is on the other side. Brown with a great fake, incomplete. He tried it, his tight end, Pat Fitzgerald.
Woo. I tell you, you can never predict what Coach Makovic will do. Third and inches like that, I would have thought he would have gone to try to make the first down, Brent, eat up more clock time, keep his offense on the field, move it down, then if I don't make it, kick a shorter field goal.
Wow. A field goal right now from this distance might be easier for Dawson from this angle. I'm not saying that it is. This is a 26-yarder. If he goes ahead and kicks it, it'll make it 16-6. So a 26-yard field goal by Dawson. The lead is back now to 10 points with 7:55. The clock now is set against the Aggies. CFA College Football on ABC brought to you by Pontiac and your local Pontiac dealer. We are driving excitement. UPS, moving at the speed of business. Microsoft, where do you want to go today? And Canon, so advanced, it is simple. Well, on their last two possessions, Texas A&M has driven to the 3 and the 5 yard lines of Texas, but they've settled for field goals both times. And now Dawson will kick it off. And remember, they have been keeping it out of McElroy's hands. They have been kicking it short along the ground, not giving McElroy a chance to burn him. And it isn't likely that they're going to change that strategy, yeah? Well, how about that for respect? They've given the Aggies the ball near midfield. Daniel Campbell to the 40-yard line.
For respect. But see, that's the negative of trying something like that right there, Brent. I mentioned it earlier, the last time they did it. This time they got it out 8 more yards. Last time it was the 32. This time it's the 40.
Makovic looking through what he might do offensively. 7:50. Each team with 2 timeouts left. Now pulling from the shotgun, fires complete. An 8-yard gain. Working back over the middle to the fullback. They've used Smith as a receiver. Tyson King, the defender.
They're hurrying up now, getting their shotgun, Brent.
Needing to put points on the board in a hurry. Trailing it by 10. Incomplete.
Tony Brackett's 98. A good penetration in there. Tipped that football. He's been a factor in the entire ballgame. Every snap.
Heck of a player.
Gary Darnell told me he would be a factor. He said, put the camera on that guy. You'll see him make some football plays. One of the best guys I've coached at that position. And he's coached a few, didn't he?
3rd and 3. Inside to McElroy. First down inside the 40-yard line.
Little shuffle pass there. Nice one. And good pull by Calvin Collins, the offensive right guard, coming around. They suck the defensive end upfield by pulling the quarterback along the line of scrimmage, then flip it forward.
So it's a first down for the Aggies. Pulling yanks down the snap. Got another completion to Connell. And this is inside the 30. And this will be close to another first down. Inside of 7 minutes, the clock critical to the Aggies. They move the chains and the clock stops as they reset the chains. Then they will restart the clock.
These guys have been really tough to beat when leading at halftime. They've had 32 straight wins when leading at halftime. The horns have. Makovic's 15-0-1.
And the Aggies are unbeaten in 31 straight here in Kyle
Stadium.
Field.
That's even more spectacular.
And he puts it in Oliver's hands for another first down. 3 consecutive first downs on 3 plays. Clock stops again at the 6:43 mark. The chains will move.
The zone is a little too loose. The pass rush is not getting there. Down 4 getting a little bit tired. Fast offense, effective. They're going to have to change up here, Brent. Going to have to take some chances here if they want to slow them down.
Aggies continue with the fast break.
Yeah, they're tightening up now. Here comes the blitz.
Pull it. Yeah, fumble! And the horns pounce on it.
Gary Darnell, defensive coordinator, came up with a great call. They had a change up from that zone.
That was Brackens jarring the ball loose and Kyle Richardson making a great recovery. And that is turnover number 5 on the day.
Locked it loose. There it is, the ball on the ground. good job of defensive coaching, decision making. You take a chance when you come with a blitz. If they pick it up, your corners are out there isolated one and one. They didn't get it picked up properly. Good job by the secondary.
Now what's critical for the Longhorns here, coach, is not to turn it over, to eat a little clock if they're going to make off with an upset in College Station and go to a Tier 1. If they want to head to New Orleans or Miami, they're 6.5 minutes away. Williams, who's had a monster. Mickens, I see, is back. He has returned after being shaken up in that last series.
When you run outside like that, you know, your tight ends has got to do a good job of sealing now. You'll see they run the counter. Tight end, that's Bradley, does a nice job of sealing. There's a nice guard block right there. There's another good tackle block. When your tight end can block a seven technique defensive end like that, you can run outside.
So Mickens locked up with Adams, who made one of the monster plays of the game. And now Sean Mitchell dances for a first down.
Eating up the clock. It's so easy now for the Aggies to be aggressive defensively because they're aggressive all the time. They don't feel like they're taking a chance when they're coming after you. Texas A&M at home. 31-1.
It's on the line now. .555 on the snap. Mitchell, right side.
Great block, Brent.
As he got the corner turned over there on that far side.
That was
Trent Driver.
A pancake block. Offensive lineman pulled around the corner there, and he got a pancake block. I mean, that was a knockdown battle block right there. That was big Dan Neal. No wonder Sizemore told me that guy was a fine player.
Second down and 5. Well, you think of some of the other names, huh, from the Southwest Conference. Tom Landry, Jack Pardee, Forrest Gregg, Buddy Dial, E.J. Hollett. Now Sean Mitchell.
Corby Brooks that time pulled from the left guard position around outside the tight end's block and sealed the defense and allowed the running back to get outside. They're going to have to move the defense to the tight end side. He hasn't quit, has he?
Evo says, this one's history, folks. I'm going to get out of here before someone thinks about hamburger and that bonfire in the same sentence.
They're eating up clock time. They're going to have to widen the defensive end because he's not whipping the tight end's block. He's got to widen to an outside shade, Brent. If they don't, they're going to keep running those kind of plays on him.
5 minutes. Williams in the deep. Running back set. Brown goes deep, incomplete. And Coach Makovic went for the knockout punch.
Isn't that something? You can never really totally predict what he's going to do. His assistants told me the other day, he says, you know, Coach Mack, he's going to sit around. I mean, he's going after you all the time. Here he has a 4 minute, 58 seconds to go. He has a 10-point lead on first down. He comes with a strong play action to throw it. Look at it. Very confident.
That's an itch over there on the left side. It's not Brown describing his performance in the least today. He has been a gamer. Injured ankle and all, especially after halftime, we noticed. And seems to have loosened up just a little bit. But you cannot say enough about what the sophomore quarterback from Beaumont, Texas, has accomplished here in one of the toughest environments in the nation to win. We don't have to tell you that. You saw the graphic, 31 straight. The Aggies have won here. They've beaten the Horns 10 of their last 11 games.
With that 147 yards, he's become the single season record holder in terms of passing yards for the Horns too, Brent. He's done an outstanding job. You talk about a bad ankle. Good thing it was his left one, not his right one.
That's coming up next. The SEC Championship. presented by Dr. Pepper. 4:55. And the horns moving the clock. Jasper defensively. And at 4:40, up by 10, you would not think that the horns would run a high-risk play here. They'll be very content with the wind at the back of punter Mark Schultes to punt it away. This is the first, this is the third down, and then if they don't make it, they'll punt it away. Governor George W. Bush is here watching. Senator Phil Graham, a presidential candidate, Senator Kay, Bailey Hutchison, all watching here today. And now comes the punt. And now, if you're a member of the punting team for Texas, you better get ready, because the Aggies are coming hard after this one.
Now, he has not had one blocked all year, but early in the game, they got close there with a little bit of pressure, Brent.
A&M will call a timeout. There's 3:51 to go. We'll be right back with the final 3:51. John Spagnuolo.
Brett, you know, with all the success the Aggies have enjoyed over the last 4 or 5 years, the one black eye they have is their inability to beat a top 10 team. Take a look, they played in 93 and 94, Notre Dame ranked 5th and 4th, lost both of those games in the Cotton Bowl. This year they played number 7 Colorado and lost. Today they're playing number 9 Texas and losing 16-6.
And time running out on them, John. Schultes.
Good protection. Nice punt.
Mickens. Penalty flag.
Great coverage.
And that was Bryant Westbrook down the field with the coverage and a penalty flag.
A starting corner in the fourth quarter, final minutes to go, making another big play. He's played awfully well, and on special teams as well.
I'll tell you, in watching Maccabi dissect this team, if I was owner of an NFL team and I was looking for a coach, I'd think long and hard about John Maccabi. It has not been easy going down here in Texas for him. He has not been the most popular person in Austin. And I'm here to tell you, he is a big-time coach who sets a wonderful offense. It has been a bit of a clinic, and remember, he's doing it with a quarterback on a tender left ankle. John had a shot once in the NFL.
He got fired the year he won 9 ball games.
First down now. Pull it.
Out of bounds.
Out of bounds. His foot was on the line. I believe you can probably see it right there, and it will be.
You were talking about John. You know, he has a year to go in his contract, and they really haven't said anything to him about what they're going to do with him. I really think if they have any class at all, they better get him signed right away and give him a real good raise, because he's done an unbelievable job. Now, he's not a tobacco chewer and a hard beer drinker. He likes the Napa Valley Cabernets and that kind of stuff, but he's a good, good football coach.
Second down and 5. He's across the line and out of bounds. Dick, I look at it from an entirely different perspective. I think John Maccabi is in an outstanding position right now, to tell you the truth.
Oh, no question. No question. They booed him at halftime last week. They booed him at halftime last week because he decided to sit on the clock. You know?
It's crazy.
Yeah, it is crazy. Hey, this one's got to be real sweet, John.
Over the middle.
It's interference. No call. Boy, it looked like he got there a little bit early. That's Trey Thomas. He's both of those safeties. Chris Carter and Trey Thomas have played awfully well. And they're concerned about especially Chris Carter playing that safety position and attacking them from an offensive standpoint. They both have played well.
I can remember, Dick, we were in Champaign, Illinois.
I remember.
Coach Makovic had a little quarterback by the name of Jason Verduzco. It was the year Colorado and McCartney won the national championship, or a share of it, with Georgia Tech. And he carved him up in Champaign that day. And it was basically the way he kept that Colorado defense off balance. It's fourth down now. McElroy, I mean, you come in here to Aggy Land, you are looking at one of the premier programs in America down here defensively. And John's defensive staff deserves a lot of credit.
They've
kept the Aggies out of the end zone. McElroy, one of the great talents in the country. 3:22 to go. He's been able to get 16 points on that board with a gimpy quarterback. Pulling throws it up for a grab. There's the penalty flag. That's a 15-yarder against the defense and a first down. 3 minutes. Makovic not happy with that call.
You almost never see him do that.
First down. Ball at the 34. And this would be Pulling's final home game. If the Aggies lose, they go to the Alamo Bowl. Down at the 32. Second down. Akins again.
Akins has been a pain in the neck all day in that side there. He just is a very, very powerful, explosive man. 6'1", 315 pounds, 500-pound bench press. Unbelievable.
I couldn't do that with a crane. Chuck it down. And McElroy in a foot race. Down the 18-yard line, and Bryant Westbrook makes still another huge play. But the Aggies with a life.
Put the ball in your best football player's hands as many times as you can put it in there. Shotgun, direct snap, come back, shuffle pass forward. Good block by Collins, 54. Now just good running ability, good speed. Good thing Westbrook is very fast. Well, easier to run fast not carrying the ball than it is carrying the ball.
Now 2.5 minutes to go. The Aggies with one timeout. Need a quick strike here. Waiting for the chains to be set. And that's what the delay is right now. Clock doesn't move in college football after first down. Then the chains have to be set. Then it's reset, and they're ready to go. And the clock is moving. Sir Parker.
Drop.
Aaron Oliver, intended receiver, and it'll be second and 10 from the 17-yard line. Boy, the last three possessions for the Aggies. They drove to the Texas 3, settled for a field goal. Drove to the Texas 5, settled for a field goal. Drove to the Texas 17, fumbled. They're now at the 17 again, knocking on the door. That's the sixth turnover, and they've turned the lights out in College Station. Chris Carter with the pick for the Longhorns. Let the party begin in Austin.
Playing a loose zone back there. rushing four, gets time, throws it a little bit late down the middle. Here comes Carter, the safety.
What a good football player he has been today. Steve Bernstein, the secondary coach, has got to love that guy. He's a junior too, Brent. He'll be back.
That's next.
You know, the offense has done a real good job, Brent, but the defense has went, they went to another level in playing defense today.
Well, maybe the celebrating started a little bit early over there on that side, or maybe there was a little unnecessary rough stuff. Regardless, the ball has been brought back to the 34-yard line. Final 2 minutes. 10-point lead.
You're bringing the house.
Oh, the workhorse.
Boy, can that guy tackle.
Ricky Williams, he has been the main running back here for the Horns today. And there's our genuine Chevrolet most valuable players of the game. 25 years of sponsorship, and Chevrolet donates $1,000 to both Texas and Texas A&M's general scholarship funds. They reward outstanding students for their academic achievements and to assist those in financial need.
They've been running the counter out of this formation. Here it comes.
Williams stays in bounds. Penalty flag on that far side. Williams to the 41, and there is a penalty flag thrown on that far side.
That's a very good formation to run that counter gap back to the tight end side, away from a three receiver side, because the defense has to move over, Brent, and favor that three receiver side. Face mask. Gives you a little soft corner back door toward the sideline.
You know, Dick, I picked up, among other things, this morning, the Dallas Morning News. I wanted to see what Blackie Sherrard, longtime columnist, had to say about the Southwest Conference. He wrote, as usual, a great article about it. But I was looking at the aggy type under colleges. Saw that the NCAA placed Miami on 3 years probation for violations in football, baseball, men's tennis, and women's golf. That women's golf team will get you in trouble.
So every time.
I'm telling you, you got to be careful with those women golfers.
I've been saying they've been overemphasizing that stuff for a long time, Brent. That's a first. That's a first. I never heard of that. You know, I'm sort of glad they spread it around.
So on first down in the final minute, ticks off now. '82 years of Southwest Conference memories. And we won't be seeing the SWC later next year, will we?
Is it going to be tough, though, next year?
I'll tell you, Sammy Baugh, Davey O'Brien,
Eric Dickerson,
Jerry Levias, Craig James.
You must be older than I am.
Mike Singletary.
You're not, but sometimes you have a better memory, I'll tell you that.
David Klingler. Oh, yeah, the list goes on and on, and this one's painful.
Yeah.
The last Southwest Conference championship will go to Texas. Bragging rights for an eternity. And still ahead of us, the SEC championship presented by Dr. Pepper. Danny Werfel, can he come from behind to snatch the Heisman? They say he's still in the running, and the Horn fans who are here are ready to celebrate. This senior class at Texas A&M has never lost at Kyle Field, and this senior class there has never beaten Texas A&M until today, but the deed is done.
I know one coach's wife that's really going to be excited. Arlene Makovic is really going to be fired up. She's a great coach's wife. She lives and dies every football game. She's living this one with a smile on her face.
Second down and 7. And there's your Chevrolet player of the game for the Horns. And Makovic gets ready for the ride of his life, or the dousing of his life.
The dousing, I think.
Whatever's going to happen on that sideline.
He's a very, you know, he's not an extrovert in any ways.
There you are,
ladies and gentlemen. I bet it's the best ride.
Texas hooks him one more time for the last Southwest Conference Championship. Texas now will go to a Tier 1 Alliance Bowl, either to Miami or New Orleans, 16-6. For John Spagnola and Dick Vermeil, I'm Brett Musburger saying so long from College Station. The Horns have hooked them.
Wanna House is red, not maroon, yeah, and not orange, so adjust your set.
That's right. And that was not Austin where those fireworks were going on.
Yeah, I was going to say, Longhorn fans think we're celebrating what happened in Kyle Field at College Station today. And for some reason, you just walked in the door, you're wondering what happened in the final championship game for the Southwest Conference. The outright champ is going to be Texas. The Aggies turned the ball over three times in the first half. Ricky Williams scored one of his two touchdowns on the ground in the first half. The final was 16-6. Texas wins the outright Southwest Conference Championship and the final season of the conference, either the Sugar or the Orange Bowl for them. The final game.